I want to leave a little bit of a rib there, a little bit of a support. Keep in mind, this whole fuselage is fiberglass, so you would think we'll have some integrity there anyway. But I want the grain to be going side to side. So you can see one side of this is flexible. I want the strength in this dimension. So I'll lay it out with the grains going side to side. What I want to do is I want to know exactly where that glue is going to go. Now, of course, I want to test fit that I have that rib right in the center of that rib that's molded into the canopy. This little thing is I put a little, just a drop of CA on a Q-tip and try to harden up the edges of this so I can get a real nice edge. Once the CA kicks, I'll run that grindstone in there again and that'll really give me a finished edge and a finished look. Just took a little bit of ink and on the end of a Q-tip. And again, I may want to paint that, but for right now. I do here, I'm trying to simulate some little air vents. Anyway, this is basically a copy of, well, close to what's a copy in a Spitfire. But the way it came out. And it doesn't fit exactly the way I had in mind. It's still a little bit, well. And because it's so easy to make these, I'm just going to make up another one. I'm not going to try to make any corrections to it. Once it can be drying while I'm working on these front pieces. Now on the left side, I want to have this simulated, this trim wheel. What I did, I just basically cut it and sanded it out of 1/8-inch plywood. And that's about all I'm going to get done today. It's a pattern for the shape of the dashboard. Now in a real model, it's more horizontal, vertical. It's straight up and down. And I like to angle it back always, so you can see the reflection of the glass off the instruments. And again, this is not a real prototypical. We're not going to get scored on, you know, what the instruments look like. But when the dashboard is angled just slightly, all the little detailing really looks, just jumps out at you. And as you walk around a model, the light will catch a different piece of the glass or the jewels that are in there or the switches. Everything seems to sparkle just a little nicer. So. Maybe 1/8 of an inch, and then that'll give me a little place up here for my rocker switches. Yeah, look, I've even got little tiny ones. You can make a lifetime supply, put them in an envelope, and you never have to go through this again, whether you want big ones, little ones, tiny ones. Just a great way to have a lifetime supply for almost no money at all. The closest thing we have to an anti-glare finish, and you'll notice all sandpaper is not the same color. It's not even close, in fact. So exactly where these holes are going to have to get burned back in. Now the second part is burn them through from the front to the back, and it should give us some nice cuts. And the next step is to lay this out on a piece of 16th balsa and plot out the spots where my, well, I could do it on 64th plywood, it'd be, I think, a little better. Plot out the spots where the instruments will actually reside. And what I did, and I'm going over it over and over again, I'm just taking a black Sharpie marker to darken these in, get a couple layers just so you don't see the end of the wood grain here. This is some of the things I have in my little cockpit bag of stuff. These little rhinestones, which make for great little lights. These, of course, for making, remember years ago people just put 50 of these in, and then after a while the knobs would fall off, and pretty soon The cockpit looked more like a pincushion. Don't know if I'm going to be able to use this, but this is cockpit combing, maybe for around the top of the dashboard. Throttle going in and out. At least on the air coupe, that's how it was. The air coupe Spitfire. It's just two pieces of telescoping tubing. I'll make a couple of these up for the various little controls. There's also a lever for the retractable gear. I can make that little lever up similar way with a pin and a little piece of aluminum tubing. Now that's where that little lever will reside, but I don't want to permanently epoxy him in there because I'm going to be working up here, so I'll just store him for later. Finish it. This is about all I'm going to have time for today. We're getting this took a long time to do. This took a lot longer than just putting a toothpick there. Thin CA on here. Let it kick off normally. And I'll put a final finish on this and try to get some more of the detailing on that yoke. Perfect spot for it right now to do some of the final detailing. Usually you need two or three coats of thin CA sanded between coats. Simulate this the shape. And after bending all that wire and seeing what a pain that was, boy, this looks like the lesser of two evils ultimately. This took a lot longer than I thought it would. Everything on this plane is taking longer than I thought it would. Anyway, we'll pick this up tomorrow. Yep. Sorry this is taking a minute, but this is one of the things that I know everybody just loves to see, those little jewels. Extra ones I'll save in that envelope with all the dials and gauges and things that I have extra of. Throttle kind of on-off things. Now that could be a throttle, it could be a primer. In a real airplane, the primer usually looks something similar to that. But anyway, again, we're making a fantasy dashboard. We want to try to make it as realistic, but it doesn't have to be prototypical. What I'm looking for is it leaves a nice, if you luck out, I guess, it leaves a nice shiny, the kind of look that a real switch would have. Similar to a real switch anyway. The idea of the Teflon paper is just in case a little doesn't get by. I want to get some on there, but I don't want to have a big glob. And it's always a good idea to, if you make 10 of these or 12 or whatever, and then make a few extra. And while you're all set up and fooling around this stuff, then the next time you need them, you'll either have them or you'll remember to do them. And usually when these dry up, and if you want to speed up the drying, you can always just hit them with a hairdryer, of course. Put them by a heating vent. What? Now I'm starting with just an ordinary T-pin here, and what I want to do, I want to cut up a little piece of 1/64 plywood. I fill that in with thin CA, because I want to make the little handle like we have on the emergency brake lever. Kind of a, looking at the drawings, that looks like it repeats itself over and over again. I made up about 7 of these before I found one that I really liked. And most of this stuff is just patience and just copying things that are either from pictures, books, library is a good source of books, videos. Anyway, it has the little look of the emergency brake pull lever. I'm going to mix up the red epoxy now and see if I can make this look even a little more realistic. I had to mix some red and yellow to get this color. I don't think this color is the right color. May have to paint this after I'm done, but this will certainly seal the wood grain. God, making up these little details, believe me, this takes a lot of time. It was very time consuming. But when it's all done and you're looking at little cockpit, now the trick is now is to hit this with a hairdryer, and that just thins it out and you get all the details back. Nice to try to make it as prototypical as possible. If we're real lucky, we'll get the bottom piece of the seat out of the same piece of wood, and it'll also have a similar curve in it. A little quadrant worked out pretty nice. This is all done with stuff you normally would have in a normal shop. The only thing that it's just time consuming doing this and having some little ideas on how to make some of these little parts, these little handles and switches. But I don't think it's out of anybody's skill range. White rivets with a black dot in them. Black dot. I like to try to vary it as much as possible. I don't like to make it all exactly the same. It just looks too redundant that way. I think it looks more realistic in a real airplane is all different size rivets than all the same. So this is all interconnected. I even put in that little wheel with the little bit of epoxy I had left over. Before I actually epoxy this in, I want to put the little sun, I don't know what you call this, sun eyebrow on it. And of course the easiest way is tack it right in the middle and then work your way down. 64th plywood again. Now this is something I bought when I was doing the Seafire. It's like cockpit combing. I want to see if I can use this. This kind of fits right on. Obviously it needs to be glued on. I want to see how this is going to look once it's in the... Again, they make this. It's commercial stuff they make for... Found this in a shop that specializes in RC and helicopters. I guess you could make your own out of thin tubing. But it adds a nice finished look. Sixty-fourth plywood edging for these both sides just to cover up this balsa joint, and then I'll be ready to glue this in permanently. Install the dashboard permanently. Before I paint these, I wanted to get all of this detailing done, because what will happen is this, I'll be rubbing my hand on this while I'm painting. Cut the little notch out with a brand new XL blade for the yoke. Okay, now the last thing I want to do here in this session is I want to get the inside of the cockpit painted, the glass part. Again, I got that waiting to dry, and now what I want to do is get the inside. Remember, this is on the inside, but I want to leave the glue area all around the edge where it's going to get glued. So I got to kind of go back and forth and see where this is going to get glued. Look into the cockpit, anything that you would still see in these ribs and things, that it's painted on the inside. You wouldn't see the filler or the paint that goes on the outside. So I want to make sure I keep that edge that I'll see from the outside. It's easy just to do this by hand. I left just enough around the edge where I can catch the epoxy without catching paint. trying to do is line up that I've covered all the areas that I normally would see once this is glued in. I think overall we got a pretty good representation here. I'm looking around for other little details I might want to put in here. Give it plenty of time to set up. And you get one shot with the canopy to get it on straight. You take it up and move it. Usually you smear the epoxy all over the place and it's a mess. But anyway, we'll give this our best shot. And I hope you've picked up some good ideas on doing a canopy from this tape. Doing this kind of a tape is really makes yourself... It takes longer than you ever think it does, and when you're done, you say, it wasn't bad at all. Now that I'm here, when I go to look at the beginning of the tape, I'm going to say, ooh, I remember what that was like, not having that canopy on you. Little nails around the edge. So, I've got as many as I can around there. Going to let that just sit for the next half an hour or so. 45 minutes, once that epoxy hardens up, then I can take the pins out. But it's getting near the end of the day, and I want this to be sealed, because once I start sanding it, I don't want any of the dust getting inside. And then I'll also have to mask off all the areas that'll remain clear before I start sanding on this. I don't know how much of this we're going to do. We're kind of near the end of the tape, but we'll try to get this roughly sanded in anyway today. Get some Brodak primer on it. And then pretty much we're going to be ready to finish the paintwork on the plane. And that's something I'm really looking forward to. I just was using up old pins here, so I have some of each. Is twist the pin a little bit as you pull it out and kind of unscrew it. And the reason is you don't put a strain on. That wood is kind of thin there. The canopy obviously is thin. Now what happens is everywhere there was a pin, there's a little tiny hole. And what I'm going to do when I take the epoxy, I'm going to heat up some epoxy and just put one little drop down in each one of the holes with a toothpick. And what that does, it acts like little rivets or little staples to even make it stronger. And even though that may seem, it may seem like, yeah, wow, that's overkill. My canopy never fell off before. What happens is, what I'm looking for here is a plane that, like some of the planes we've been lucky enough to have 10, 15 years. I think we've got one 17 years old, too, still flying. But as the planes get older and older, this is one of the areas that it'll start warping and you may be subject to having some bubbles or something. And I think just having that rigid there, it's just one of the things that I'd like to maintain. After all that work we did on the canopy, I just hate to see this side of the fuselage warp out or something crazy like that. This is now like a little focal point of the plane. And if we're lucky enough, it'll last in the entire life of the plane without the seat coming loose or without who knows what. In model aviation, everything's a surprise, but that we don't have something that we normally wouldn't have to deal with there. I'm going to take the rest of these pins out and see if I can get these little holes filled in. And I maybe put epoxy right down in each one of those holes. That'll really make it solid. Again, I want to be able to pick the plane up by that canopy. Okay, now all the epoxy on the edges is dried. Next step, I'm going to mask off the windows very, very carefully so that as I'm sanding and grinding and priming, I don't get any scratches on the glass at all after all the work Midgley did on that. You can even see the rivets on the inside of the canopy. I really like that. I like that effect. The nice thing about doing this is any canopy work, you can really do as much detailing, or you can, if you choose, you could just paint the canopy on, or in some cases, people don't even put a canopy on. Okay, I got this whole thing sealed up. Now I can start working my sanding operation in here. And obviously, maybe I'll even put a piece of tin foil over here. Or something to protect that. But I need to sand this, get this blend real nice, decide just how I'm going to seal that edge up. I know this will be one place, well, we'll do a test, see if Brodak primer. This is the kind of spot where getting a nice smooth fill, that white Brodak primer seems to be just one of the things that really works well. And then of course, probably on the next tape, we'll silver this all in and we'll be ready to start. We have to finish the tape with the trim on it yet. Well, it's, can't wait to see this in full camo. Every time I look at it, I get more excited about seeing it done. Now on this DVD, we're going to try to do the cockpit for the big job. Now what I did, I put some, what I thought were little outtakes from a 10, well it's actually an 11, it's actually an 11 year old DVD when we made the I-beam Spitfire. Because what I wanted to show, that the technology of making a cockpit is really timeless. It, whether you super detail it, as on a semi-scale plane, which we did on our Spitfire, our 90 Spitfire. We did on a Seafire a sliding canopy mimicking Keith Trossel's Martin Baker that we got to see in real life, and we kind of were inspired by that. But when it comes to the big job, we're not going to do a semi-scale canopy. But here's the thing I like about having a video library that goes back 23 years. As I get an idea, I look at something, I say, how did I make the stick? How did I make that little thing? How did I put the rivets inside the canopy? How did I make the radio? And if I have the DVD, it just makes it so much easier to replicate. Now, my goal is to make a very simple canopy, but very neat and methodical. But again, it's the same technology. The technology doesn't change from plane to plane. And what I always try to do is before I get on a project that I haven't done in a long time, and I really only do this once or maybe twice a year, what I try to do is take out from my video library, which I did, watch the video, and a lot of times I'll just be watching it in the background while we're building, and I pick up, oh yeah, I forgot how I did that. Oh yeah, I did that before that. I pick up the sequence of things, I picture how I do it, how I did it. Now, there's also another reason I wanted to do these in sequence. I wanted to kind of do a simple cockpit. I sure didn't want to just paint something on. It would not be in keeping with the project. But years ago, they did kind of a traditional cockpit. A couple of pinheads, a couple of instruments. And if I did this dashboard in a big job, I think it might, I don't know. It might just not really fit the bill of what I'm looking for, but the good news is, and there's always good news, the silver that we did on the last DVD is just about as nice as you could ever expect. Fuselage has been sitting up under a heating vent. We're going to be ready to sink the canopy down. We already have the canopies tinted, and I even made a spare one, of course, just in case. But what I wanted to do is, before I make any decision on a cockpit, I like to watch the old videos. I like to look at some of the old ideas. And it just makes it, I don't know, it just, each model that I build has a little personality all its own and a little, I don't know, I take pictures of them and I dream about them at night and hug them and kiss them and whatever. Each one of them is a tribute to somebody or something. And I always think that some people measure their lives by what car they owned or what the trip or vacation they went on or whatever. Maybe I'm a little old-fashioned, but I kind of measure my life each year by the plane I built in that building season. And this year, it's the big job. So let's get cracking on this canopy detail. I'm ready. Now, as I'm getting ready and getting all my little stuff in order, I noticed one thing. The snow has already started, and it's going to continue for the next day and a half to 2 days. They're expecting 12 to 18 inches. But it'll interrupt us some, but it's basically going to mean that we're going to get a good day of building today. This will work to our favor. I wanted to get a real early start this morning, but it just doesn't look like it's going to work out that way. But
It doesn't matter because we definitely, the only thing we're going to do today is work on that cockpit detail. And as you can imagine, it's a winter wonderland as we expect more and more of this stuff to be falling all day, well, the next 2 days. And normally when we're snowed in like this, it just means, well, what's good is that we got all that silver painted, because you can imagine trying to paint out there today. Yeah, it's not happening, but yeah, let's get started. Let's get that coffee warmed up. Let's get going.
Now to lay out this cockpit, and again, this is not going to be as complicated as a Spitfire, a Seafire, or a Typhoon canopy. And by the way, all of those, there's a video of showing how to do all of them, including the Seafire with the sliding canopy. But this one is going to be relatively simple. And the thing with a cockpit detailing job is you make it as complicated as you like. First thing is to decide. We got to get it right off the plans. Step one, I dyed these canopies on a previous video, of course. And I always make an extra one. In fact, I made a third one for Billy for his Strega. So the first thing I want to see with these canopies is right about where they're going to go in place so they'd be scale. So we've got the nose ring lined up, and it looks like we're about the length of tape away from the end. But the first step is I have to trim around here, just take off this extra flashing. And we also have a DVD on how to mold canopies that Midgley showed on one of his one of the trips we made up to the old shop, how a vacuum forming machine makes these, and how we made the canopies and the molds. All the planes that we've had, Spitfire, the Seafire, the big Spitfire, we've made the molds for those canopies, and that may be interesting to somebody. We have all those DVDs. Now, one thing I found real helpful, I have a pair of these scissors that has a little bit of a curve in it. I'm not sure what they really use these for in the real world. I think they're used for taking stitches out when you cut yourself all up. A lot of times when you go to take all this flashing off, one of the things you notice is I can't get a nice straight line. Well, these scissors, and again, I don't know what they're really used for in the real world, but these allow you more or less to get in the corner and get a little bit nicer cut. Especially when you're going around the back on the back edge or... Now, one of the things I remember is when Dave molded up all these canopies, he molded up the 90 Spitfire canopies and the Seafire and the whatnot from our molds. He had a wide variety of materials and thicknesses that he could use. It wasn't just one thing that you could use. You could use 20, 30, 40 thousandths material. So now I would say if you're doing a real fancy canopy, well, yeah, that extra material when you have ribs in the canopy and riveting detail and the whatnot, it kind of pays. But on a cockpit like this, just using an ordinary, inexpensive SIG Brodak type canopy, and that's where I want to start. I want to start with that piece, that flashing cut off. Now, some people are very intimidated by having to put a canopy on a model. And we purposely made this split line on the fuselage. If it wasn't for having a canopy, this would have been up here. The closer we could have gotten to the wing, the better it would have been. But the first thing is to determine what this front cut is going to be. What's going to happen is the front of this is not going to match up. Let me just show this up close, because this is part of it that can be a little bit intimidating. And the first thing we have to do is to get it to sit down in that groove. So we need to take a little bit at a time until we get the exact cut that we want. Now the first part with those curved scissors, I can just go in there and take a bite out of that to get this process going. But then from that point on, I want to take little ice shavings, little by little by little, because I want that to fit as nice as possible before I can go to the next step. And by the way, that's another good thing you can pick up off why I like having a video library, because I can go back right now and look at other videos of cockpit detailing and say, oh, I'd like to include that in this model. Even though this is going to be simple, I want this to be as nice as possible. Now to get a rough idea, what I can do is just by holding this in place, I can take my Sharpie marker and just hold it up against the fuselage and get a little bit of that curve. Now I'll go way underneath that to begin with, and then little by little just start dropping it down and dropping it down until I pick up that shape. And this is where having that, just a guideline, I can go underneath it right now. And this is where the curved scissors seem to be a little bit of a help. I can just nip away a little bit of that in a reverse curve. Right now I don't have to be accurate. At this point in time, I just need to know roughly how much of that material is going to come off. Because if I don't do this, it's just not going to make sense. That front is going to... See, the one thing I want to avoid at all costs is having a big fillet around the canopy. As soon as you do that, paint bubbles, blisters. The idea is to get this fuselage and this to be a razor joint right along the edge. And then you know, you absolutely know, that you've minimized the chance that that paint is going to pull away from the canopy. And here you've got it all beautifully buffed in and everything, and then boop, there's a bubble there. So just to start, that's a good little place to start. Okay, our second fitting, now it's just like sheetrock work. You put a piece of sheetrock in place, and wherever it hits, you nip that off. Then a bigger piece hits, but wherever it hits, you're constantly chipping away at the part that hits. I call that a sheetrock fit. Very common in house renovations. Something, gladly, I learned from John DeTavio, saved me a lot of work. Some of the little tricks of the trade. Okay, now we've got what I think is close to the total height and the side fit. And you can see each time around, we're getting closer and closer. Now we're ultimately going to get a little closer than that. I can take a little more off. Just a little more from maybe here forward. And then the last little bit, we have a little trick to get the last little bit of a fit. And those curved scissors really are very helpful. Not a deal breaker if you don't have them, but this is one thing I want to get really accurate. And the reason for having an accurate fit here, there's a lot of things, is I don't want to have a big fillet. As soon as you have a fillet, you have invited disaster. It's like putting a fillet between the rudder and the tail. You're just asking for trouble. Now if I can get in here and get, I'm right up to actually where the pen line told me I would be with this little curve. And that's the whole thing in all of modeling. If you get used to getting things to fit where you don't have big fillets and globs, the whole reason, if in Victorian times they invented house molding because they never could get the wood lath to fit, so they put these big crown moldings in. Well, in modeling, it's fillets, unless you're making a scale plane. Having big 1-inch radius fillets adds all this weight that you don't need. Not only that, but then it kind of is telling the person looking at the plane, hey, nothing fits. I put a lot of molding around this, so nothing's really going to fit. Famous last words. Let's see how close we're getting. We're getting closer each time we do this. Now we need, I would say we're within, I'm going to start taking a 64th of an inch out. Right in the front, it needs to have some taken out. But little by little, it's a sheetrock fit, and this is going down, down, down. And before we can do anything, we have to position the canopy, get it set where it's going to be, or how do we make the details, and the detail would be wider or something out of keeping with the canopy. And each time you do this, it's just, if you take small amounts, each time you take a small amount, until I get to where it's just about touching, and I try to look by eye, see if I have it even, although in the end we have a little way to get it perfectly even. I'm trying to look from every possible angle to see that I've got this close. And a lot of people kind of rush right through this and try to see, I'm sighting down this way, I can see this side is a little higher, so I can make it more symmetrical. symmetrical that way. Well, close enough for now. But as we always do, now we're getting even closer and closer. Now I can see the spots where it's not fitting perfectly. I still need to take just a little more out of the front here. Now, the nice thing about doing this, and why I always tell people to make an extra canopy, because while I'm dyeing this up and I have a bucket of dye, it's just as easy to do two or three or five canopies. But if we get this one in some way that we're not happy with it, we cut it too much, I don't want to say, oh, well, we'll just have a canopy an eighth of an inch high. I can use this for a pattern then, put this one over my spare canopy, and use this for a pattern. So, and in the worst of all worlds, I'll just have a spare canopy. It's no problem. But right now, we got the positioning real close, and I still need to take just, and I'm going, each time I cut, I'm cutting half of the amount I cut the time before. Each time, just a little bit, because I want this to just sit right down. And again, I want to, when this is all done, and I'm all ready for putting filler and paint, I want to have an edge, not a fillet, not a big glob of epoxy around the end of it, or CA or something. I want it to be just a razor where it looks like somebody with a laser machine went in and cut that canopy in. Little by little, just nipping away at the front. So we have this about as close as we can reasonably expect to get it, given the fact that we want to get this perfect. There's one final step. There's one little way we can make this even just a little bit nicer. Take some sticky back sandpaper, rub it up on an old flannel shirt, any shirt, t-shirt, a couple of times, because we don't want it to be too sticky. Put that sticky back paper right down on the fuse. Doesn't have to be pressed down too hard. But now we can take our canopy, and by doing this, in a matter of a minute or two, we have that, what I call a final fit. It also gets the angle, in other words, from cutting this with a scissor, it doesn't have the angle for the joint. Even though we're going to cut a little ditch, we'd like to have that angle real close if possible. Now, I've heard people say you can do this, and if you don't have this part of the fuselage to work off conveniently, you can do this with a baseball bat, which they're probably pretty correct about that. Okay, now that gets us, and I want to make sure we have this trued up. Actually, in the real world, having it a little bit rough is good. So it'll let the epoxy get a better grip when we actually go to put this on for real. And if you were in doubt about taking this off, heat it with a heat gun. If you neglect for some reason to press it up on your shirt and get rid of some of that stickiness. No, I just thought I'd mention one of the things you can do when you have a take apart plane. You can make the cockpit removable. For whatever reason, and in fact, the idea was when I did the Typhoon, you could take the cockpit out for FAI flying and put it back in for AMA flying, where you got appearance points. So, and it was about an ounce, so it was not an insignificant amount of stuff. So anyway, what I wanted to show is, and this is a significant thing, and I've had this happen to me in the past. I'd get this, and I've got this edge pretty well sheetrock fitted in. But the problem is, you got to squeeze it to make it fit. See, I don't want to have this that I have to squeeze it, because then I've put a stress on the canopy, and you run the risk that maybe it'll crack at some future time. I don't want to have that, of course. Not after all this work. So the next thing is, and it's going to be pretty simple, we just need to hold this in position, and I want to trace the outline of this. This is why it's nice to have the fuselage in silver when you do this. It's really a nice little way to do it. This is a good way to position a canopy too. And Karen just came down with a cup of coffee and said, the snow is really building up out there. I should get out and work on it.
Nah, let it snow.
See what happens in my neighborhood. I guess it's pretty cool for me, but not for my neighbors. I have the only real heavy-duty snowblower in the neighborhood, so when we get a real storm, I try to be the good neighbor and get out there. Most of the people are elderly, most of them are widows in this neighborhood. So I try to go out and at least make it that they can get out of their houses. And
to be honest, I like my snowblower. It's like a big Rojet 90.
But you know what? Today I'm excited about getting this done. So my neighbors will have to starve or not have milk or whatever, because I want to at least get this moving along today. Okay, the idea of that is I want this edge as rough as possible, right up to where I'm going to use it. And I don't want to scratch, so as soon as I can, I'll cover this with tape, realistically, so I don't, as Joe Adamusco so famously says, I don't gouge it up. Now I want to position it and I want to make sure, see, in the past, let me show this. I have seen planes, and mine have been some of them, with a cockpits like that or like that. I want to really make sure before I do anything that I have this on. Let me get some tape. And that's the beauty of using tape. The beauty of using tape is I can't find it. I'll have to go get another roll. I want to just, let's see if I can get this centered. It will be very nice if I can get this just centered. Looking straight down from the top. See, it's off to this as I say that. This is just to hold it in position. Let's see if I can get this. I believe you, most people don't spend this amount of time getting it lined up like this, but I do. Make sure I can feel that I got the feel just right. Now this is just a temporary thing, but let me go around the edge. Now, we're not going to be able to, let me just show this. You know what, I got to get a new blade. I'm going to make sure I have a brand new blade. Now, what I want to do is I want to go right around this. I can get rid of this right now. Put this up in the front. I would never just glue this in place. There's a simple reason. There'd be a good chance it'd snap or come off or something, or break or crack. I don't know exactly what, but I don't want to find out. And I consider as a modeler that one of the nice things about a model plane, a model railroad, is the detailing. Without the detailing, it's a big part of the reason for doing this is diminished. Now I want to get this accurate as I can. And once I have this real accurate, and that's why all these old videos going back to the sweeper, this same exact, I call it the box method.
if you take this part of the fuselage and you just try to do detailing, well, especially if the wing is in the way, what a nightmare. You got to have chopsticks and all kinds of things. But using the box method, which we've used a million times already, this allows us a little more freedom. Boy, I want to have a new blade here. Because, boy, when somebody looks at the cockpit, they usually focus right in. And if something is cockeyed or something not right. And my rule, of course, not doesn't apply to this model, is if you make a painted-on cockpit, the color of the cockpit should be nowhere else on the model so that it identifies, oh, that's something different. It's not just a paint stripe or a bullseye or something. Now the next thing is I have to connect the dots here, just a tad. And when I've seen other people's cockpit detailing, I've just been amazed at some of the scale models that are just incredible, incredible. Like, we were in a museum one time looking at Keith Martin Baker, and he was making the stick move, and it had it. Just, I got so many good ideas from that one model, and having it on video so I can go back and look at the switches that we used on probably 7 or 8 models already, all came from that. And there was a plane, I don't remember the person's name, it was that Brodax with a twin-engine German bomber. They were on the FAI team and practicing at Brodax, and he was showing the detailing. And like model railroading, it's the detailing that sets it apart. Without the details, it's, you may as well paint it with house paint. Now, what this tells me, this is my footprint. And again, a lot of the things you can get even off the older videos. Remember, we have over 1,000, it's actually coming up on 1,100. It's going to be 1,100 very soon. Because we have 900 and some modern ones, and then we have about 100 that are in the vault, but they're basically, it's impossible to copy them without great expense. The 87 Nats is one of them that's, it looks like it may be lost forever because I never converted it to DVD. Now I want to see how much of a radius I have in the back here. This is easier to do with this method. And I've noticed a lot of people, especially people in our club, that several people in our club, in fact, not just one, that once you show them how to do something, it seems like, wow, it's real easy to do it. But boy, if nobody takes the time to show them or help them or whatever, it doesn't really happen. Now I'm just going to temporarily, I'm going to have to do this a little differently in the back. And this tape is just on here, just temporarily anyway. And I think if you're, even if you're a very accomplished modeler, which most of my subscribers are, Rich Wallbridge or whatever, and they really, there's always something you can learn. There's always some way you can make it quicker or better or cheaper or drink more coffee or whatever. Okay, we've got that. That looks pretty good, right where we would want to have it. Now the next thing, because I know I'm going to start carving and making a mess here, I want to protect the fuselage around this with some masking tape, but I don't want to take a chance right now. I'm pulling up the paint, so what I do is just take an old flannel shirt, which I'm always wearing old clothes, so it's very easy. I don't have to worry about it. And just back mask everything up to where we're going to work. And I can do this in pieces, it won't even matter. Because I know I have the curve pretty accurate now.
and this will help. And you want to get completely around the perimeter, so I'm only working in the cockpit area. Okay, so that's going to protect this. Now the next step I want to do, I want to carve with a brand new number 11 blade, and it's not real intimidating. I want to go down about a 16th of an inch and make a little ditch in the whole perimeter. The whole way around here, I want it to be a ditch. So that when this cockpit sits on there, it doesn't just sit flat and have a little glue point at the bottom. I want it to fit down into a ditch so I can get that to be as solid as possible. And I don't want to, this usually takes me a little bit of time because I go about it very, very slow and methodically. I want to go the thickness of the canopy in here with a brand new blade. Now this can be a little intimidating at first because I don't want to go down into and come out the other end of the block. So the first thing is I want to get a line right up against the tape, just the slightest little line. And it doesn't take too much effort just to score the silk span. Now what I'm doing, I'm going back in pretty much the thickness of the canopy, but it's not critical, of course. Both of these cuts will be pretty much done away with when we're done. Now, let me just see if, and I'm not sure we can show this the way I want. Now, once I have that in there, now I go back on the same line, again, a brand new blade, and I do this two or three times just to score it. The same way if you want to make a dovetail joint, you'd keep scoring and scoring and scoring. Now that I've got it scored, I can cut this at the end. I can do one little piece at a time. And I can start picking out the material. And it takes a little time. It's not a real instant gratification thing, but in the end, I can go up against this edge, and then I go up against the other edge. See, I'm cutting down this way and then this way. And I'll ultimately then, by having a little piece of sandpaper run around there, I will have me. Here comes a nice big piece out at once. I'll have me a nice, now I can take, again, the back end of a blade, not the sharp end. And just go down in there and dig a little bit of that material out. And once I get to that point, now I can go to the next piece, the next piece, the next piece, right down the whole part. Now I've got the ditch just rough carved in there, nothing fancy, just roughed out. Now the next thing I wanted to do, I wanted to take and put masking tape on the inside also, because I want to fold up some sandpaper and roughen that up even just a little bit more so that that canopy just drops right in. And I don't want to go so far in that, of course, I come out the other side of the fuselage. And I don't want to scuff this all up. I don't want to have fingerprints and everything in here. I might want to use that inside the cockpit. Now I can fold up some 220 sandpaper and just get right in there and rough that out without scratching and scuffing everything up.
And just an ordinary piece of old sandpaper. Now I can capture the angle that plastic is going to reside in there. It's not going to go in this way. It's going to go in, and I can sand into the angle. It makes it a little rougher, makes the ditch a little more defined. trying to capture the angle every inch of the way of how this would reside. Now up here it's going to reside a little bit differently. Now when we made the Strega, this was very funny. And I had made the video of making a cockpit, and we got to the Nats the next year, and I saw three or four Stregas, and the cockpit was really similar. In fact, Rich Jacobones is almost a mirror image of mine, among others. And I looked, and Brian had a nice little cockpit in his, and I said, yeah, well, maybe it is worthwhile making these videos, who knows. And I certainly have gotten ideas from other people. And well, I think without the sharing of those ideas, I think we're really all like poor. So, but this idea with the little ditch, this is one of the better ones.
And after a few minutes of just sanding that edge out, but again, trying to get the edge so that the edge would mimic the angle that the cockpit's going to go on. No, I look around for where it's not sitting straight. And this is why it pays to get that nice angle right in there, a perfect angle, or as accurate as possible. Oh, that's nice. I'm so happy with the way that worked out. I'm gonna go make myself another cup of coffee. And check out the snowfall, because we are on a, it's one of those days. A great modeling day. This will get that cockpit detail going right down the road. Gevalia coffee. If you've never experienced Gevalia coffee, you don't know what you're missing.
Well, it hasn't, it's still snowing just a little bit, but they were saying 18 inches. I don't know. Guess we're really going to find out pretty soon. But it's a nice feeling to be snowbound and have a nice model to work on and some fresh coffee. And there's some days it's good being windy. It'll be good being windy up until about 5 o'clock when I got to go back out there and chop ice again and everything.
This is about the third time we filled a feeder today. They poor guys, they see what they do, they huddle in that tree. And as soon as they see me open a window, fill the feeder, Wendy, fill the feeder.
Ah, it's good to be windy.
Until it's time to plow tonight.
Oh man. That's what I love about model aviation.
So we've been checking the weather report, but you know what? Another storm's coming after this one? Mm-hmm. Is that what they said? Great. Maybe I'll get the paint job started today, too.
Do you think they love me? Do you guys love me? Or is this a relationship based on food? Or do you really know I love birds? Oh, yeah. A day like today, we'll go through three or four of those feeders. And these guys, I don't know how many of them, they're like on windy welfare here. But we love it.
It's turning into an ice storm, huh?
Maybe not. Hard to tell. It's just not the big, thick snowflakes we had before.
No, it's still snowing. Forget it. It's still snowing out there. We were hoping this would all go to Washington.
There we go. New Jersey winter blast.
Winter blast from New Jersey. Bergen County is our county. Yep, that's what it looks like outside. Forget it. A great day to be a model airplane builder.
Oh yes, it's turning into an ice storm. Isn't that lovely?
What it means is we'll get...
Look at this light. You can tell how much snow we've got, and it looks like 6 inches or so. But we're tough, and we have that Rojet 90 powered snowblower, so in a couple hours I'll get back out there. Do my thing.
Okay, the next thing is I wanted to mask out the area because I want to make a little box. I don't want to cut this yet. I want to make the box first and then fit the box, use the box itself to cut this hole. If I cut the hole and then try to make a box to fit it, twice the amount of work. So this is just a tentative spot of where that's going to go. So needless to say, I wanted to make sure I have it parallel. I don't have it skewed. I have these lines 90 degrees and I kind of look at it right from the top and that I have the same gap on both sides. So the first thing on this is to take a piece of 16th balsa and cut the floor, what'll be the floor of our cockpit. That bird got back in the house?
Absolutely.
Now I just need to get the width on this. Cut this out first. Get the width so that I have a mimic of that size. Okay, and we have a pattern now to start. This will be the floor. Now the idea is using our floor pattern to come up with, and actually we can make four of these. It won't matter because the ones in front and back we're going to trim down and we're going to angle. We're going to put them on a little bit of an angle too. Once we work off, we can just make up four and that'll be the easiest way to do this. It's all going to get trimmed down anyway because I don't know how deep I want to put this down into the fuselage, but it's always better to make it deeper to begin with, and then after you're done with that, the reason I'm trying to be very careful about maintaining 90 degrees because I don't want to have a box that's like an egg crate, and by just go over to the cutting pad and cut these accurately, it's going to make making the box, and this method, by the way, late 60s, I had detailed out this method in the first article I wrote for magazine publishing on the sweeper. If you go back and look at those plans, it shows how to make a box like this. And this actually, I wish I could say it was my idea. It was Harold Price's idea. And sometimes making up one of these boxes can be a little bit, I'm not sure what the right word is, but a little more difficult than you originally think it's going to be. I'm not sure why. But if you start with a square box with all the corners square, I think you, and then we're going to angle the dashboard back just a little bit. We'll do that after we have the box roughed out. It just pays early on to try to keep everything 90 degrees. Now, when I'm trying to make a surface inside the cockpit look like it's an anti-glare dull finish, one of the best materials to use either for a dashboard or a floor or anything is ordinary 600 grit sandpaper. It doesn't matter. In fact, what's nice about it, if you have some of a lot of different grits, each one is a little different tone, so it kind of looks three-dimensional. The worst thing in the world is just paint the whole inside of the cockpit one color. You want to have different variations, different textures, different shades. At least I do anyway. So the easiest way to do this, since we're going to build a box, this will make getting the floor in a box really easy. It'll make it extremely easy. We'll just get some thick CA on here. And that'll give us a nice texture on the floor. The floor texture will look correct for what looks when you look inside of an airplane. The floor isn't painted white, it isn't chrome. It'll have a similar like a catwalk. That non-slip texture. So as soon as this, I'll just let it kick out without kicker, trim it off, and we're ready to make the walls of the box. Now with the box just tacked together, I can do all the trimming on the outside. I want it to set the angle. This is going to be the angle for the dashboard, and what I want to do is make the first part of the dashboard, the back, and I want to have a little bit of a curve to the top of it just make it look a little more realistic by doing that. So I'll use this for a pattern and just transpose out a nice curve onto the top. And this is now the back piece of our dashboard. And this is the part around which we're going to build all the gauges and dials or whatever we're going to do here. And that's the next step. Once we true up that box, this part doesn't go in until it's finished. And it just makes getting inside and doing all the finishing a lot easier. Set the angle, I want to grind that angle in there, just a slight angle, maybe 5-10 degrees, so that when you look in, if this is 90 degrees, you don't really see the glass on the instruments, but a little bit of an angle, it just adds some interest to it. Now at this point, it's important to have the dashboard removable because it's oversized. We made this longer than it has to be, and we've made the box higher than it has to be. We don't know the total length yet until we sink this in. So the next step is, and this, because this piece is removable, we just want to, well, be very careful that we don't cut the hole the wrong size. Now this is going to be a job for a brand new blade, and what I'm going to do is, of course, cut it undersized by maybe a 32nd of an inch, and then little by little, because we have an angle, this will drop in. At some point in time, I can adjust that opening, because I want this to be a nice drop fit right into the hole. Now, as you can imagine, as I can imagine anyway, I sure don't want to cut this and have it that I've cut too much. So I'm taking a brand new razor and just scoring this. And I don't want to chew up that silver if I can help it. I want the last little bit of this, the end amount, to be very carefully and of course it's cutting that end grain, it's going to be a problem. The other side is going to be relatively easy. I look back and I think how many cockpits I've done in my, wow, illustrious career. A lot. But it's really a compliment when you see somebody else who's mimicked your way of doing things and you've been able to pass that on. I find it very rewarding anyway. Now this is totally undersized because otherwise I'm going to have a problem with this, and I'll take a sanding block or a sanding stick and I'll open it up little by little. I'm trying to hold the razor at 90 degrees to the way I want this to come out. So we can get inside there and push it up. I may want to save that. It shows you how accurate we've hollowed the block out. Now I may need to cut that. May need to cut that spine, but I'll try to cut it in a way that I can connect my box to it. But the next thing is to just carefully to make this hole the size that I can just drop this in and maintain that paintage if possible. Now, of course, what we're looking for is a nice tight fit here. So what I did, I put the part in, it just starts to fit, but I don't want to press it. I'm going to get the last little bit of clearance. And I used the tape to allow myself mark off about a 1/64 on each side. So that lets me use this as a pattern. I can do two things. I can shave it with a brand new blade. I can just take some little shavings, ice shavings off until that part drops down there. Now I marked off inside the fuselage where the push rod would reside. One of the things, and I've done this in the past, I've built a beautiful cockpit that hit the push rod and I had to cut one of them. I don't know, it was one of the Spitfires I think I had. At the very end I had to get in and cut everything up so the push rod wasn't rubbing on it. Well, we don't want to do that, of course. Now, before I even go to the other side, a nice landing gear block and some sandpaper, because I want this to be a press fit. And I marked off up here how much I have to take off. Since it's end grain, it's easier to do it with a sanding block. Again, back to that old rule that if you make the sanding tool, the jobs just get easier and easier. And the point is, I have a box over on the table with about 500 of these different tools in, and I keep making new ones. There's just never a time when I have enough. Let me get in here. Now, on a little bit of an unrelated topic, but I just thought I'd pass it along. You've seen on many windy videos, our friend Doran Morisano has been really helpful with prop molds and real high-tech stuff. He's a really excellent machinist. Well, he announced today, when I spoke to him, I was talking to him about the project, he said he's going to be a daddy soon. So, and we wish him all the best. Now, I also need to account for, because I don't have it in there yet, my little dashboard. And everything is oversized here, of course. And I need to see how far down I can sink this. Because by looking inside and seeing where the push rod's going to reside, I got a little bit of, I can sink it down another 3/8 of an inch or so. So the next thing I got to do is pull all this apart. This is kind of a close enough fit now. I have to go in here and plot out where I have to cut away this spine, but I don't want to cut so much away that I can't connect it, because by connecting everything, I'm going to build some strength there. Now with that piece out, I can look in here, and I've tried to make a thing that I can connect the dots. See, I know where the push rod should be. I've got that marked out. So just by having a nice tight fit in here, my little box can act as a little bit of a former. So at least it's not just going along for the ride. Which I love that sound. It, in theory, would add some structure to this, I hope. And if you can add some strength without adding weight anytime in a build, you're going to be ahead of the person who's doing decoupage and just going in the other direction, I guess is the right word. I want to dress that edge off. I don't want that tissue to start peeling back if I can help it. I got to be real careful taking that tape off now. That's the other thing. So now we can decide how low we want to, and of course the lower we go, the more of a former this becomes. Ooh, that fits nice. I got to look inside and see if I'm near the area. No, I'm not. I'm actually in good shape. I can take this down almost all the way. Some of the way, anyway. And once my dashboard is in there, see, I like to have everything that I can see what this is going to frame up like before I do all the detailing on it. That fits really nice. And if you can, I don't know, I don't think you can see in the back, but I can get in there with glue, another advantage of a take-apart plane. Get in there with glue and turn this into some structure.
So the lovely Mrs. Artnowski has just informed me that it's time to go shovel some snow on the porch. That it looks like it's building up pretty big out there. And we need to, of course, in our case, we need to get the mail every day. And our postman has just been better than good, so we don't want him tripping and falling like I did on the ice. And we'll get back to this project after lunch. Now, we've got a good fit around everything at this point, but as you angle a former forward, it isn't a straight line anymore. So if we were to put this former in, of course, that would be fine. But as we angle it forward, we need to account for the fact that this is going to have a little bit of an angle. And I'm just going to do this very, very carefully with a sanding block. I have a sanding block and keep checking the fit because it's going to be about, 32nd of an inch in the middle, but it's going to be a curved line because we have a curve going into a straight. It's not just going to be a straight line.
I can just interpolate this ever so slightly. It's going to be about this thick in the middle, but it's not going to go off on the edge. Now, it's a little detail, granted, but when you're looking at the cockpit, I don't want to see it, that it's wrong. I want to see that it's as accurate as I can make it. And if I hold the knife on the angle that that's going to be on, let's just see if we're even close on this. I want all these parts to fit as close as possible before I go to the next step. Because once I have this box that it fits in here, if you go off the video and you just go step by step, you should have no problem at all. It's figuring out the steps in a logical sequence that just can be not intimidating, but if you haven't done it before, can be confusing, or that you miss a step or skip a step or whatever.
I've got that angle close, all these angles on the side. Now the final thing is just to decide how far down we want this to sit in here. And it can go down just far enough that it's not interfering with the push rod. I can actually make it go a little bit deeper than that. And then I want to mark the whole edge, because then I have my permanent shape that's going to go back in here.
Now I've got this even here. And this is just going to be my reference line for how much of this gets cut off. Back here we can almost, we're going to put a chair back in there, so that's not going to be a problem. And this is just going to be my guideline now. Now, as I take this apart, and it's just like the benefits of a take-apart plane, I want to work on my dashboard, but I sure don't want to work on it while it's in there. That's going to just be a nightmare. I want to work on detailing this part out, making a seat, a yoke, and whatever, but I don't want to work on it while it's in here. So I can pretty much put this part aside now. I'm done with this. I got a little chip and a silver I've got to touch up. But other than that, this is relatively clean. And the way that worked out, I may leave that silver in there, I don't know. Here's the reason why. I was looking at how this looks with the tinted canopy. The silver looks a nice shade of blue, kind of a neat color. So maybe we'll leave that silver. But what we're looking for is all little different textures and details and whatever. So that's the hard part right there. That's the part that once you have this right, from this point on, it's relatively easy, relatively speaking.
Now, the more I think about, if you add all the advantages of take apart planes, the fact that we have our push rod marked out in there, and we know exactly where it's gonna go, that just makes it just a little bit easier. All right, now we're ready to work on detailing these parts out.
All right, the first thing is to just trim where we're gonna not have any material. Now, in the case of the dashboard, this is the back of the seat, of course, we'll leave maybe a 1/64 of an inch extra on there, but up here we'll leave just enough that we have a dashboard sticking up out. So I think another thing you can get out of any DVD is the sequencing of things, because a lot of times the doing of them is easy. It's like a roadmap. If you get a roadmap to go to some location, the roadmap makes it really easy to get there. But if somebody doesn't give you a roadmap, or if you're trying to find it by going east and west, a lot of times it just gets frustrating. And the objective of modeling is not to see if you can be frustrated for your whole life. The idea is to build some nice planes, get them out to the flying field, enjoy flying them, enjoy interacting with the people you're with, have some barbecues, travel around the country, pretend you're a rock star. Nobody's ever asked me to play the violin. I don't get that part of it. Anyway, I want to just true this up, because this is going to be something. This part has to drop in and be equal all around and give me a nice edge around everything before I go to the next step.
Now, a little detail I want to incorporate here. I evened this off with the back, and I want to have this go down maybe 1/16 of an inch. Otherwise, this starts to look like just a piece of wood. But just another little detail we can put in, and it's easy to put it in now. It's very difficult later on. I'm not sure how this is going to be once I put some finish on it, but I think it'll be a little more interesting than just having a flat there. The thing I always try to incorporate is little angles and edges that add some interest without making it either so complex you can't build it, Now, actually, once you have this part done, and I've spent as much as a month in the middle of the winter working on canopies, that one on a Seafly with the sliding mechanism. When I watch that video, I think, how the hell did I ever put that much time into a cockpit? But you know what? It was a 20-point plane, won 2 concourses. A lot of people enjoyed seeing it. And the biggest part of all, I still have it. It didn't go by the way of some mechanical failure or whatever. And actually, we could just pull it off the wall. We even have the lines for all our planes in the museum. Lines and handle set. For that day that comes that we want to go relive the past. Joe Adamusco was always talking about reliving one of our original Spitfire days. Okay, so that added a little dimension. Now, you can't believe what kind of a neighborhood we live in. We have a friend down at the end of the block here who's a World War II veteran. We're always talking about Mustangs and P-38s and stuff. He came by with his snowblower and gave me a free shoveling. Actually, we were going to go get him a cupcake. Hey, Ron! Ron! He's gone. That's the kind of neighborhood we live in. See, I do this for other people, and then I guess it's my turn to collect on one of these goodwill things. I don't know, but it's blowing, and boy, it's coming down now, baby. We're the real deal right now. This is the real deal. The real McCoy.
This is some blizzard, huh? huh?
Yeah. Yeah, when he comes by again, give him a cupcake. Fatten him up. This is pretty cool.
You coming back?
Nah. He did the girls on the corner.
He's come back and forth a few times.
When I go out tonight, I'll do everybody's.
You know what?
So I get a little bit of a break anyway. My neighbors, who I do their stuff from time to time or when they're on vacation, and we have a great neighborhood, I really have to say. Anyway, what this is, and I've had this for years now, I made up, it's Brodak dope. I mixed it to the color of zinc chromate, yellow and green, and I made some a little bit darker, a little bit lighter, so it shows as three-dimensional. When you make things like the lightning holes, you just use the darker and the lighter, and it presents as two different colors. So I've had this for so many years, I had to put a little bit of retarder down in there, stir it up. A little bit of talcum powder on it, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to get the primer finish, the first coat on all of the little edges, and while that's drying, I'll start making up the dashboard. So something is always drying here. Now, the idea of this material is that it's dull and it's kind of prototypical, semi-prototypical. An awful lot of like warbirds have this zinc chromate aluminum finish inside, and this is really just a primer first coat, because we're going to detail, I don't know exactly how yet, we're going to detail some of this out anyway. Now, I haven't decided exactly how I want to do this individual cockpit, since it's an old-time stunt plane. I just think if you put a Spitfire cockpit in here, it would kind of look, I don't know, like putting saddlebags on an R1 or something, or a roof on a horse, or whatever. So we're going to be a little on a conservative side. But again, I want the things to look really nice. And I remember that article I wrote in Control Line World last year, I think, or the year before, about the Spitfire doing up the dashboards and everything. And I gotten real nice response to that, but there aren't that many people left building semi-scale planes. The few that are probably have their own techniques. But it's still nice sharing that stuff. Now, if the paint dries too shiny, I just add a little bit of talc. If it dries too dull, then I just have to, play it by ear until I get the look of the finish that I want. I want a little bit of a dull finish. Again, it's texture and color. I don't want it to look like it all came out of the same jar. And I want it to be little different shades of different colors as I go to detail this out. Now, the next step on this, I want to make up the little dashboard. Now, what I do, and I've done it over the years, I have an envelope with some writing on it that says cockpit stuff, save everything. And what used to happen is, years ago, anybody in a club, or Joe Adamusco in particular, used to combine all our cockpit stuff together. And when somebody was doing a cockpit, they could borrow this, because there were always some fun little things in here. I never know what's left in it the next time I open it up. Sometimes there's new stuff, sometimes not. But let me just show what could happen. Oh my God, look at me, what a lucky boy I am. When you have a cockpit box, first off, this is from it's from chocolates or something, but it's nice thick plastic that we can use to make our glass for our instruments. We have some of the little jewels that we've used, Michaels, we bought these years ago for the Spitfires and stuff. And every one of the cockpit detail videos, of which there, in fact, there's some extra switches in here. I just see from the Spitfire, oh, we're going to have some switches. And I got this idea from Keith Drossel on his Martin Baker. So we also have, and oh my God, lucky me. I don't even know what's in here, but it looks important. These are all little knobs and pins and extra things that I made up. Actually, there's some more switches in here. There's some more of these little things that... Anyway, we have a little container of that. See, all this stuff migrates. We have all kinds of little thin tubing, things bent into rings. And some of the things Joe Adamusco's provided with us, actual pictures of cockpits. Now what you do is you go buy a set of these instruments, and they're expensive, but you buy a set. And then you go to a copying machine in Staples, and you make bigger ones, smaller ones, all different sizes, because you need to have all, I must have 1,000 instruments here. Just as an example of things I save, because you only use one or two out of each selection. So we have a nice selection. I have some of this material, which is really just balsa wood, that I've burned with a grindstone, burned the holes in. This is extra from one of the projects. We have some nice little instruments. We have some more simulated, some for the Typhoon, some for the Spitfire. We got the original little glasses, which I never thought were realistic looking, but I save it anyway. Well, here's the glasses here. I don't really even use these. I have my own method of making these, and it's worked very well for me over the years. And then when I'm done with everything here, what's going to happen is it's all going to go back in the envelope. And let's say, even it doesn't matter who you are, if you're building a plane and you want to do some of this stuff, I'm more than happy to send you my cockpit envelope. Then whatever you have extra, put it in here, send it back to me. The next guy, Mike Estella, be the next one, or whoever it is, you can use all our cockpit stuff, because the amount you'll use is negligible. And in the end, we'll always have more. We'll have more than we started with. And if you add something to it, like these pins, all these fancy little things I have. Also, I had some felt. And I don't remember if I was making mats for one of the cockpits or rugs, or I keep it in a cockpit bag anyway. But the hardest thing here is to just decide what it is you want to make. Well, now that we have all this stuff sitting up on the table here, now it gets a little easier. We know this is the size that our dashboard is going to be. So the first realistic step on this to make this easy is I want to put some wet and dry sandpaper on one side. And what that wet and dry sandpaper is going to allow me to do, it gives this a texture without having to paint it. Now I'd like it to be, I don't want 600 sandpaper, because then it's going to look exactly like the floor. I'd like it to have a little different texture, so I can look in my drawer full of all sandpaper scraps and find one that's just a little bit different texture than the 600. Now, whenever I have a scrap of sandpaper, this is a piece I've taken bites and chunks of. I want to find a clean spot for it. Now, one of the nice parts about doing this is, and I think it's, well, it's something that's worked well for me anyway. Using this method, it not only goes relatively quickly, but you get a lot of texture and a lot of different looks and shapes and everything without a ton of extra painting and waiting for things to dry. You really, especially on a snowy day like this, my little fingers are itching to get going here. Now once that's dried up, then we can cut the holes for the instruments, and we do that with a grindstone. Now I want to clean this up, and I want to get my little grindstone out and the Dremel tool and just burn holes in here in what looks like something like what a dashboard would look like. And of course, it's not scale, it's not semi-scale, it's just, this is just a fun replication of an old-time stunt plane. Now, I don't want the holes to be prototypical to anything, but by having a pointy grindstone, I want them to be various different sizes. and in something that looks like what a real airplane would be, on some spots for switches. As he walks into things. Now, the thing that's nice about this, it leaves a relatively nice look on the front, and I can just with my bare hands take this, the edge off. And if you want to make it even more dramatic, I could take an ink marker in here. In fact, maybe I'll do that. Now, because we're looking for different textures here, this will give us, I just roughen this up, I'd like it to be a little bit different than the 600 sandpaper on the back. And I'd like to have this edge be dressed off. But the whole idea here is not to have everything look like it came out of the same batch of paper. Now, if you work from the back with a Sharpie, it leaves a little bit of a radius, which makes it more three-dimensional, which is nice. All the rules that apply to model railroading, scenery, texture, variation in color, they all apply to cockpit detailing for whatever reason. Now, what's nice is if you do it that way, it leaves a little bit of that white edge, which kind of defines when this is sitting and the sun hits the glass. It gives you a lot of little realistic looking things going on there. Now the next step on this is 64th plywood usually has a smooth edge, a rough edge. I want the smooth edge, not the rough edge. I want to put this on there and I want to trace out relatively carefully where these instruments might be. Now, believe it or not, there was a time when I tried to cut little pieces of that clear plastic and make instrument. It really never worked out well. The method that I'm showing now worked out perfectly. You just put the whole sheet of plastic in there and you don't even see it. Now, that tells us where these are. Now, it's just a question of finding the instruments we want to put in here. And one glob of thick CA on them, and that's it. I'm not sure it could get any easier than that. That just gets to be about as easy as you could imagine. And we sandwich in between that clear plastic that comes off a cookie tray, or actually, you probably could buy it in a hobby shop too. That is a very convenient, easy way to make almost any dashboard, unless you're compelled to make it exactly scale. I'm not even sure you couldn't make this. What I'm not sure you couldn't do is do a photo enlargement of the real dashboard and then glue it to 64th plywood and put all the holes in it. I don't know, but scale modelers would know that a lot more than I would. This certainly serves our purposes very conveniently. Now it's a question of just picking out the instruments that we want from our enormous inventory here. Some of them will be a little bit too big, some of them a little too small. We'll find the right size. That size right there looks like it's going to be perfect right there. Now, one of the things they give you if you really go to this extreme level, some of these are for boats, some are for World War II, World War I. I don't think it really matters. These here are just about nice, too. These are too big. These are just the right size. So, this is going to be real easy. Cut this piece out. And these will be the instruments that we use. And it's just a question then of positioning which of these you like and making them look relatively realistic. Now, every time you add one, I just put the slightest little drop of CA there. I don't want too much. I'm not holding in a bell crank or anything with these. Now, if for instance you get one that doesn't sit exactly the way you're happy with, just put another one right on top of it. So what happens is every time I do this and I go and see if I like the way that looks, and if you miss by a little bit, just put another one right on top. It's really not as critical as you think it might be, but it sure gives a nice little look. When that clear plastic is in there, it really does look nice. And as that, especially when you're out in the sun and you just happen to be looking at the model and all of a sudden all that clear plastic and all those little jewels sparkle, it really catches your eye. And before I laminate the plastic in there, I want to make sure I have the look that I'm kind of looking for. And when that plastic's in there, I think that's really going to set it off. Now, of course, I don't want to get any extra glue down in where the instruments are going to be. So I'm kind of being a little selective about how much glue to get on here. And it looks like that might be, if I'm lucky, if it's my lucky day. Let's see where it is. No wrinkles or anything on here. I just let that dry until that should be a minute or two to kick off. Make sure no glue gets out. If you see glue oozing into where the instruments are, just pull it off and clean it up and move to another spot of the piece. Now, this has the plastic already on it, which is ready to go here. I want to clean that up. I want to just double check that I'm not missing something. And when that sun hits that little glass, I don't know if I can show that. I would just think that always impressed me. Now the trick is, same thing, not to get glue where we don't need it. And then we'll glue the edge on this, because I don't want to have glue out on the instruments. You get to drop this in position once. Let's see if we can be, if it's our lucky day. Once I know it's lined up to the best of my ability, and just hold this for a few minutes. Now I glue the edge of this, and I need to true this up and make sure it hasn't changed the shape that I'm looking for. This has a little bit of an angle in it, which I want to put back into the part. This has a little bit of an angle. This will have to put a finish on eventually, or a little lid, a little top. Now the next thing I want to do is go into that bag of little stuff that I have left over from other cockpits and see, we can put some throttle here, maybe some other little things. Now what I wanted to do, I wanted to see how much of this I have to trim away. We'll find out in a hurry. I always want to make sure everything fits back in place. I want to make sure this is not too high, and I think it is. I may have to trim some of this off. Because what's going to happen when I go to put the cockpit on here, it's not going to look right. The dashboard is a little bit too high. Yeah, I can trim some of that down. I think it'll look better with it down. It's a little bit too far up. I'm trying to think of what other choice. Yeah, there's no choice. So what I'll do is I'll just cut this off, cut the two bottom instruments off. It's no big deal. Now what I want to do is I want to marry this edge up to the front here. And one of the things I want to make is the little sun shield kind of hood on this. It's really, I just make it oversized and then trim it back once I get the fit that I want. The smooth side on top. Actually, I can move it back just a little bit. Just looking at this, I can get it right in the middle. That little sun hood, I don't know what you would call it. Just adds one more little detail, and we drop that in. Gives it a little three-dimensional look. Now I want to get a throttle quadrant and some more detailing on this. At least I know I'm not painting myself into a corner here. I always like to, at every stage, take everything apart and make sure it's still a good fit. Oh yes, we're gonna have fun shoveling tonight. Boy, it has just gone off the chart. Holy mackerel, Andy.
This looks like the Christmas blizzard where we had 14
The big
inches.
Christmas blizzard, yeah. Oh, I don't know. This may impede my canopy detail here some. Well, right, when it snows, though, it really does look spectacular. It really is something. And we are really getting snowed on. Now, I took a little coffee break, but I know I'm going out in this tonight. I noticed Ron isn't doing it a second time for me. In between all our snow adventures here, this is the material. It's got a little bit of talc in it, and the reason, as soon as it dries, I'll sand it just a little bit. That'll make it a little bit duller and smoother, and then we'll put one more coat on. This can all be drying, of course. But the main thing is, this is the part you're going to see. I want to have a nice edge on this. And it's all the edges that I want to make sure they're really nice. Well, we had no idea how the weather was going to play out today. Boy, it's played out. I'll call Midgley later and see how he's doing. He usually gets it worse than we do. All part of the great adventure of being alive. In a time of global warming, when the whole planet is getting warmer by the minute, except if you live in New Jersey. And building up this kind of a little quick finish here, usually two or three coats of this result in a nice patina, like a little bit of a zinc chromate finish. Actually, considering the weather, I'm making some pretty good progress today. But we have no control over that at whatsoever. And we ducked this enormous storm that went to Washington. We didn't get a drop. Now we're celebrating. I don't know if Washington, well, we'll find out tonight on the news. But for Karen and I to be snowbound in this house that we've worked on for so many years and tried to make as comfortable and family-oriented, modeling-oriented, motorcycle-oriented, model railroad-oriented, I don't know what it is, but we sure, on a day like today, I appreciate that I have a nice house and I don't live, people that don't know, I used to live in a mobile home years and years ago. Don't live there anymore. Actually, these people that I'm going to Daytona to see, Ray and Artie, who you'll see on Windy Videos in the next couple of weeks or so, we all lived in mobile homes together. That's how we met each other. We rode motorcycles and lived in mobile homes. What a combo.
The next thing we want to do is establish where we're going to put our various... First thing I want to do is make up a throttle quadrant, and that's real easy. Now, in the old days, people just shoved hundreds of these pins in the dashboard. Well, we hope we can upgrade that just a little bit, but one of the things that makes it look a little bit better, if you can take a little piece of this really thin aluminum tubing, some realistic amount, this can just go in here. Now what would normally happen is you'd have a piece the next size bigger tubing that would connect to that. So the next level of upgrading this is going to be, we're going to take the next size bigger tubing and just slice off a little piece. No part of this is really exotic. Now I may have to trim that with a number 11 blade to get that to go in there nice. Nope, I lied. Now one drop of CA on that, and that looks a lot more like a throttle quadrant than if you just shoved the pin in there. Now I put a little washer up on the dashboard, and it gives it a little bit of a three-dimensional look. These are the switches that we made, kind of from watching Keith Trussell's, the interview with Keith Trussell and a Martin Baker, we picked up this little tip, and these were very easy to make. What they're a pin that's smashed flat, and then a little washer and some epoxy with dye in it. And it's a simulated on-off switch that you'd see in a typical modern airplane.
Now most of our dashboards include these little indicator lights. In fact, here's the one I want, a red one. Red, green, and yellow, which would be pretty typical of various functions on a full-size aircraft. And what I do, I take a, I'm sure you can see this, take a number 11 blade and just twist it. Because what that does, it makes a relatively nice little pocket for the jewel to sit in. And this really adds a little interest. In fact, I remember on a Seafoyer, at appearance judging, people looking in and seeing all the little details. I mean, in the Seafoyer, we had among other things, a thermos and whimsically a pizza box with a pizza pie. Not sure he was delivering a pizza to Winston Churchill or something. But it seemed to go over pretty well. Now, I put a drop of thick CA out here and a toothpick. This gets a little difficult. It's actually more difficult to do this than it probably looks on video. I just get a drop of thick CA in there. And then I try, up right up to the last minute, I try to grab these with these little forceps that have been filed down. Look at that, you got it on the first shot. We got to make sure we got some glue on that. And you can see when you do hold that into the light, there's various angles it'll sparkle at, or sun will hit it, and it really does add a nice little touch. But of course, all of this is in the eye of the beholder, and it's not going to get us one extra point at VSC. You're not going to get anybody to shovel my whole driveway for nothing. It's just like gravity, it's a given. Now this is pretty much ready, it's finished. This we need to paint up around the top here, which I haven't done yet. But that's ready pretty much to install. And the next thing is I want to make up two more things maybe I could even get done in this session. I want to make a yoke. In fact, I ought to make the yoke right now. Now, I don't know. I know this is a habit from many years of doing this. I always put everything back together and see if I've missed the boat, because every once in a while, you miss the boat. Or I missed the boat anyway. Now, this part I think is ready. Seat, yoke. And when we're done, we'll see if we want to put a radio in there. We're probably going to have legitimate one or two more days of detailing, but... And whether it's worth it or not is strictly in the eye of the beholder. Or if it's not worth it, well, you know, that's all in the eye of the beholder. I remember when I was detailing out the model railroad and adding passengers to the passenger cars and doing a bunch of stuff that I'm sure nobody ever got to see except me. But then when I think about it, I'm in the running here. Anyway, my friend Arnie would come over. You've seen Arnie on videos many times, and he has an enormous railroad, 3-4 times the size of mine. He's nobody else see that. But Arnie, I see it. The gods see everywhere. Now, even little details like this, and the idea is, if you were to try to build this whole unit up while it was inside a plane, especially inside a plane that had the wing in place, boy, that would be a nightmare. To me, maybe it's just me, but I would just think that would be difficult to do. I would be impressed when I see that. But this little method, and again, Harold Price was the one that he showed me this one time, and I was gone. I didn't need to see this twice. And rest his soul, all the things he taught me have served me well, both in business and in life and in modeling. Actually, a lot of the skills he taught me about painting are helping me with my motorcycle business and helping me in this endeavor. And maybe you've even learned something along the way. Heaven forbid. Now, because we're going on plywood, this may only need two coats, I don't know. I didn't want to overdo this either. I was trying to find a happy balance between, it looks just right for an old-time plane. It didn't have the look of a full-scale stunner. And I hope we've got it. But again, this all is in the eye of the beholder. And there should be no part of this that an average skill modeler can't do reasonably easily and within a couple days. I mean, we're going to be done with this in one, maybe two, the worst, two more days.
Now, our joystick, we just used two pieces of tubing, one size bigger than the other, CA'd it all together, sealed it all with CA, and it's ready to paint. As soon as the paint dries, I want to make a little piece like a boot for the floor, usually a washer. I can find an aluminum washer or something of that nature. Glue that in place, and that'll be our little yoke. Okay, so what I did, the yoke, to make the equivalent of a boot, like where a shifter boot would be, and I'll paint this black, and that'll be our little yoke.
So once that painted, that, and it has the nice look of the aluminum. And that gives us the area to now that we have available to make a seat. And while a little glue is drying up here on parts, get a next coat of flat green on here. Because this is a part that we're going to see very, very obvious right through the canopy. Now that I'm happy with the position of this, you can just CA it. Okay, the next thing I want to lay out is the size of the seat. But the back of the seat, I want to go higher than this, but not inordinately high, maybe a half an inch higher. So I'll make up a pattern first for the seat. That's all that. This so far, this is less than one full session's work. So what this is going to allow me to see is just how much bigger the back of that seat wants to be. Now, what I have to do is, first thing, and I'll use up some quarter-inch scrap here, get some idea of how wide I want to make this seat. That looks like it's going to be fine. Then I need to, there'll be a joint down at the bottom. I need to know the length will be that. And how high it'll be, usually twice as high as wide, is a good start. We'll adjust that. I'm just looking at this right now. That'll give me enough material to carve. Now we have the part cut out. One of the ways that makes this, you can just save a little bit of time and energy, is just carve both pieces at once before we cut it. And we want to make a little bit of a shape to it. I don't want it to just be a flat. I'd like it to have a little bit of a shape to it. Because most aviation seats have some kind of a little shape to them anyway. Now in one of the models, and I don't remember which one, I had a piece of material that had a curve in it that I had molded for some other project, and I looked, I didn't have any, so that's the reason we're carving this. I thought, I don't remember which ship it was, but we had some of that material that had a curve in it. Boy, was that convenient. Now I remember having Ski Dombrowski's lace maker in my shop at the old house, and he had gone out to get a pizza, and Bill Suarez and I were appearance point in his plane without him knowing it, and we were looking at, he had hand carved the whole seat, and it had these little like a rolled and pleated interior would have. And when he came back, I said, geez, you know, that's unbelievable. You had the wrinkles in the part of the seat where you sit. And he said, yeah, well, he took a picture of a real seat from a home-built plane, and he noticed that the wrinkles were down at the bottom, were were just wrinkly, and up here they were nice and straight. And he said, well, being the detailed model that he was, we just saw him this fall too. He's still around. But like all of us, we're all getting older. Not sure how many more years we have in a tank left, but whatever it is, it is. And I think, to a big degree, I think all modeling keeps you young. There's just no counterpoint to that. Not to me, there's not. Now, once we get this shape, it'll be easy then. We can just cut the part, go over to the model, and see if we've made this an appropriate shape or if we're way off base. Okay, now we can cut this, and then we'll be able to put the kink in it. Now, just by looking at this, I need to get a 45-degree angle on this, or some angle, so I can make a laid-back seat, an upright seat, a little, just a hair, tiny amount laid-back. How much more do I want to make that laid back? Do, 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 do. I don't want to overdo it. Too laid back. Nice thing about this is if we get this done tonight, which we will, and we'll go out and shovel, of course. What's going to happen is I can paint this and get the finish on it, so tomorrow we can glue this in and button up the canopy. Everything will be dry. That'll be a big help. Now I can just play with this angle until I'm happy with the angle of the seat. Still a little bit too laid back. Now, of course, none of this matters if we don't like the look of once this is installed. You know, I put the harness pieces in there, ground in with a little grindstone tip. And now the last thing is, of course, I got to radius. This can stay flat because that gives me a nice place to a good glue joint, but I can radius this off until it has the simulated look of sheet metal, like a real sheet, a real seat with a sheet. And we're pretty much going to be ready to give this guy a quick finish, maybe a coat or two of thick CA. And once I get that shape in there, we'll be good to go here very soon. And so despite the snow and despite anything that could have slowed us down, we actually got the lion's share it is done in one day. A little bit nicer. Yeah, I like to look at this from a lot of different angles before I make a decision. But I think that's pretty much good to go. And the next step, of course, we'll take it all apart and put the finish on the seat. A couple of coats of thick CA and just brush on some flat dope. This will just minimize the amount of the coats of dope that we need to get in there. I need a little handle to hold it too. And I take a little bit of black, and I said plenty of talcum powder. A little bit of thinner in this. This is just to make it flat because the seat shouldn't be shiny, it should be flat. This will give us a dull finish. A little bit of retarder in there, a little bit of thinner or something to thin it out. Now I found that little thing, I was trying to hold this with a pin, that didn't work. And I can put varying amounts of talc in here. This will actually cover it probably in one or two coats. Just so it dries dull. I just don't think it'll look realistic if it's bright and shiny, but we'll give it a couple of coats of this talc concoction. And by tomorrow, we'll be ready to glue this all together, assuming the abominable snowman doesn't get us. Been a pretty good day. I always say a good day of modeling really puts you in a good frame of mind. You can see how much talc is in there. This is going to be thick as can be. Thick as jello. And that is definitely going to look real nice. I'm really excited about that. I'll come back to this tomorrow and finish it. Hopefully finish it. So you want to see the latest look in snow fashion? There you have it, Ferrari owners. Look at that. Is that? But believe me, in this weather, laugh all you want. Oh boy, Schmidlap, it's a winter wonderland out here. And we got work ahead of us. So do we want to ride motorcycles today? Or play with our snowblower? Oh, lucky us, we got a snowblower. Look at this, the wind is blowing my snow shovel over. Oh. Yes, sir. I can't wait to get to Daytona and VSC. Boy, today did nothing to change my mind. You can't really tell how much work this was. This was unbelievable. Now, had I not gotten that silver sprayed the other day, we're dead in the water here. Just totally dead. And it's 5 more inches coming tomorrow or tonight. I don't even know. Look at this wall. This wall is like 36 inches high and it's half buried. So if you're living in some nice warm weather climate right now and sitting there and drinking a soda or something, trust me, the only thing that's going to work for me tonight is enormous amounts of Gevalia coffee. Look at this. Just unbelievable. It's almost indescribable how miserable it is out here. Well, we started off the day with a nice email from Elaine. Yeah, they look like little mischievous little children.
This one looks like he's an imp.
Yep. Yeah, he has the windy look in his eye. Wait, let's see if we can break something.
A couple more.
Bob and Elaine, two of our favorite people. We're going to see them at VSC in a couple of weeks, 3 weeks, whatever. Nice way to start the day.
This one has a...
Okay, this morning, our seat is dried up because it's got brush marks. We're going to take some 600 sandpaper and just try to get rid of some of the brush marks and then spray on a final coat. I was hoping to make this a little bit duller than shiny, but I guess I'm going to have to compromise. Anyway, those little edges and angles, every part of this we want to detail out. You'll see how nice we can make this. And then we'll be ready to, sometime later today, we'll be ready to, once this dries, be ready to button this guy up. Now, I just thought of something I could do to make this a flat finish. I could spray it with, I have some black primer, some flat black. In fact, I have some flat black, the paint they use on barbecues, which would be flat too. So, but I would like to have the, in fact, I'm going to try that. I'm getting one step ahead of myself here. But the first thing is to get it sanded smooth so we don't have too many of these brush marks on. And once that is actually done, I'm going to see if we can do that a barbecue paint. Yeah, put some coffee on, that's for sure.
There's always room for coffee.
What I want to do this outside. This is the high heat. It's really barbecue paint. We've used this on motorcycle mufflers and different things that we do. But the idea is if you look at the cap, it leaves like a flat. And we'll find out if it's flat. Now we put the dope with the talc on here and have kind of a smoothed out. Well, it doesn't have to be perfect because the flatter you make the finish, the more it covers up the flaws. And there's nothing an extra cup of coffee won't cure, even if things aren't going right in the shop. Even if we are a little slow to get started this morning. Now this is supposed to dry flat black like a barbecue, which I thought would be a little nicer. Maybe this is a good tip, I don't know. If it isn't, it's not a big deal, but because this is something we have in inventory all the time for doing motorcycle parts and when we used to have a black barbecue, I'd paint it every year before the season started. Now we have stainless steel, so we don't really need the paint. Now we'll just see. I'm going to let this dry up normally. And if this is to our liking, well, it'll be very easy to... I thought of another thing we could do with this. If this doesn't work, I have some of that typewriter paint, that wrinkle finish, which may look like more like vinyl. There's another trick you can do if you want to make it look like I remember this trick from model airplanes. You can take a piece of a sea sponge and dip it into paint that's just about dry and just dab it on and it makes like a wrinkly, like vinyl slipcovers are. So it's just going to take, maybe 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes. We'll see how that dries up. It looks like it's going to have, and what I'd like to have is just that it looks like a seat cover instead of a piece of plastic. While we're waiting for that seat to dry, we got some pictures in today's email of Rich Walbridge's twins. Needless to say, he's not snowed in. You kids ever see snow? You want to play in the snow? Come to Jersey. Rich, you are one lucky guy. That's all I can say. Karen and I are jealous. See, this is the kind of stuff I used to do when I was a kid. And Karen reminds me. I'm not that cute anymore. I do it now and I just look goofy. Now, I often wonder, how do you tell them apart? See, don't you get like, give one a short haircut or something? I don't know. Make one wear sunglasses. Or a funny hat. That must be it. A funny hat. Oh, Wendy, even though you're 64 going on 65, you're still a cute baby. Hey, Rich, thanks so much for sharing the photos. Karen, and she got some from Elaine Brookins today, made our snowed-in day complete. Now, these photos came in from Charlie Reeves, the big job meister, and I'm looking at, well, I don't know how different his are than mine. I'm looking at it and I'm not sure. It looks like, well, for sure he's got aluminum landing gear. I'm not even sure if this is a kit or not. I assume it's not. And from looking at Gerald Shamps, among others, I see there's a variety of ways, and Don Herdman, of course, a variety of ways to make a big job, that's for sure. Now see, this is one of the things Charlie's is a little different. He's got a piece of 64th plywood around here, which is real nice for making a seam. And see this little curve here? It gets rid of the stress riser. Now he didn't show that on the plans, but needless to say, that doesn't make it a no Barrett Jackson job, that's for sure. And what's special about this that I like, that by people, now obviously within our group of subscribers and friends and relatives and whatever, there are people that are going to build a big job in the future. And the more they can see about the various ways of building it, I think you just stack the deck in your favor, that it would be, you'd have all the options. This is real quick. This came in from Mike Estella. How to change your Volkswagen fan belt. Watch this. I was impressed with this. That is very cool. I'm not sure I'd want to try that on my Windstar. Watch those fingers. Is this time he chops his fingers off? It's pretty good. Very impressive. Now this came from Mike Estella too, some unusual aircraft. Some of these I had never seen. I'm not sure, where the hell's the pilot sit? Or maybe this is a drone. Where the hell is the pilot sit? It's a good question. Now this has the look of a nightmare waiting to happen. Some of these helicopter blades go flying around. Imagine you're up on a wing here and your buddy hits the key and those blades start spinning. Oh man, now that's pretty wild. A lot of these I had never seen, by the way. The Guppy we've all seen, made from a B-29s after World War II. This kind of nose thing, I had seen that, the stretch nose. They still have one of the two Valkyries out at Dayton. I'm not sure if this is the one that's at Dayton, but those tires, you can see the steel belts coming through those tires. Now it looks like this is being towed. Maybe this is some kind of a glider, a little short wing glider. Again, that's one I haven't seen. You may remember one of the planes similar to this from one of those Mel Gibson movies about the underworld. I can't think of it. Anyway. Now this thing has two cockpits. Look at the size of this thing. I'm not sure what this is. Never saw that one before. It's got rudders out on a wingtip. Whoa, space lines. That is unusual. And that's really cool looking. Now that gives you some thought for, we saw something similar to this, not this exact plane, down by Bill Rutherford's when we were in Texas the first time and he took us for those aerobatic rides. Very cool. That is some nice props there. Imagine if you made a model of this, you could probably put a dachshund or something inside of it. Look at the size of the fuselage. Whoa. Keep in mind, this is built from a four-engine, a B-29-sized plane. One of my personal favorites. Many people have modeled. Absolutely cool. We even had, at one time, Delmar Benjamin. I think it was Benjamin. He had built a replica of it and did aerobatics and air shows and everything with it. But there's some serious, that's a serious looking air scoop there. I guess a lot of these is when they make a purpose-built nose section. I would assume there's some radar or sonar or something in there. It isn't the most attractive plane in the world. Talk about not the most attractive plane in the world. Holy mackerel, what's in there? A giant lollipop. Another one of these oddball things. Looks like they grafted on a whole cockpit onto a plane. It almost looks like it's a Photoshop thing, but it isn't. That's a real plane. So we've seen that's Burt Rutan's spaceship that goes into outer space. We even had some video on that on one of the older videos. And who could ever forget the Dornier that was down at Teterboro, the three-engine World War II Dornier. And we got to see that personal. We got to actually got it on video taken off. It was pretty cool. That's very slick looking. Boy, if you were a scale modeler and you want to model something nobody else has, you'd be in a class by yourself here. Now, I can't even tell what this is. This looks like, it has the look of the front of a B-29 with two floats. No idea what that is. Two floats, maybe from a some kind of amphibious plane, and sitting out in the snow. That's very nice. All of the Varese family of planes, very, very slick, aerodynamic, functional looking. I'm not sure what's with all these big noses. The Jimmy Durante Air Force or something. Now that has the look of like a, the Chickie Air Force or something there. Or it gives the pilot some place to stretch his feet out. I'm not sure. Another shot of Burt Rutan's spaceship. Yeah, it's bad enough they made this plane, this giant thing, and then to paint it loud colors like it's a New Jersey Transit bus here, I don't know. But apparently some of these big things fly. Now, I wonder what they put in there. They put the space shuttle in there or I don't know. Pretty wild stuff. Now what is this, like a flying egg thing going on here? A twin rudder flying egg. And the winner in the Who Has the Longest Nose contest? I don't know, some of these guppy odoolies, they look pretty... I mean, this must be pretty awesome to see this in real life. I mean, it's in where we live in a pattern of two separate airports, and planes going into Newark and Teterboro both fly pretty much over our house from time to time. And imagine seeing this fly over. This has to be a sight to be seen. I'm going to take a wild guess that this is a British plane. Look at the air intakes. These are little things you pick up off video. You don't think it's a British plane, do you? Needs a longer nose. Now I'm looking at this. It's like a 747 body with a DC-6 wing and rudder. What's going on there? I wish they would have given some history with this, like some little commentary. I had seen this one before. That's pretty unique. Almost looks like a modern Wright Brothers plane. So where do the contestants line up for the big nose contest? I need to enter. And I have a big tail and a big rudder tip and a big nose, so I should be in contention. Now I had seen this. This is a Cricket. It's got two, looks like lawnmower engines, single cylinder engines, mounted on pods on the nose. Look how small this plane is relative to the guy flying it. Wing slats, it's a high lift wing. This is a pretty, I've seen this already. On Speed Vision, they had a little thing about this. That was pretty cool stuff. Oh, I wish I had a bigger nose. All my friends have bigger pointy noses, and here I am. I just have just an average size schnoz. Some nice paint colors there. Needless to say, it's an amphib.
Now that's unique. I like that. Instead of a nose, I have a big mouth. Does that qualify? I'd like to have that hanger. That hanger looks like you could put a lot of motorcycles in there, baby. Airbus Beluga. A beluga is a whale. I wonder if that means something. Airbus Beluga. Well, I don't know who wins this big nose contest. There's a lot of people in the playoffs, though, that's for sure. Look at this. Now, this is the rotating wing. The blades all fold. Look at this real close. This is almost like an osprey, like a giant osprey thing. Maybe it is an osprey, and that's how they fold up. I don't even know. So it can fit. It really does look like an osprey. Like it's, so it could be carrier bound. Maybe that turns in like that. Boy, there's some wild stuff. Imagine the hydraulics and gears and things that go on inside of there. Wow. Now that's pretty. That's slick looking. That is definitely cool. I should win. I have a nose, a chin, and a wing on top of my head. Why don't I win these contests? And maybe somebody could take up a collection and paint me to match, since I don't have any paint on me. Oh no. They spent millions on this fuselage, but no money for paint. I would only require about 10 million gallons of Brodak dope to finish me off. Maybe I can get Pete Klepsik to paint me. Now, I've never seen that one before. Whatever that is, it almost looks like a ducted fan, GB, with two cockpits. Could that be possible? Now I have a long nose, red paint, and 3 points on my rudder. Do I qualify for the top 10? That is pretty cool looking. I like that. Pusher. Look at the end number, SEX. Proteus. Another Burt Rattan design, of course. BD-5J, that is one cool plane. You might remember that was in a James Bond movie. He flew through a hangar sideways. This is supposedly, you can take the wings off and put this, two guys can pick it up and put it in the back of a pickup truck. I wonder what the hell this is. It's two blimps hooked together with a pusher end. Is that an engine? That's pretty unique looking. All right, so we're back to this. That looks fine. Now, a couple of things I'm going to have to take the cockpit apart. Now it's time to take the whole thing apart and decide if we want to add any detail, change any colors, do anything as we put this back together. Maybe for the final time. Now, when it comes to cockpit detail, among other things in life in general, letrosets, ink lines, there's a lot of things where if you're wrong, one less is better than one too many. I think cockpit detail fits into that narrow category of if you don't have it the way you're happy with it, if you're wrong and you have too many doodads going on here, it detracts from it. Now, I think we've reached a point at which, by this coming apart, and I wanted to show this, and just like the Control Line World article, what some of these little parts would be. In fact, I'll shoot a couple of pictures for the guys on the internet, the big job stuff. And that's pretty much what I think we're going to go with. I think the seat dried up real nice while we were doing that email. It's got a nice flat texture. So that barbecue paint is okay. So step one is I just got this now in one piece.
I'm gonna make sure everything's glued nice and solid, no glue dripped inside. Let that kick off. We'll be ready to install this right in the fuselage now as the next step. I want to be real careful pulling up all this masking tape before we put these parts together. And what would happen if I don't do this, what's going to happen is if some of the CA gets underneath the tape, we're going to have issues with the paint that I don't want. And if by some chance you've forgotten to rub the tape up on your shirt before you do this, just heat it with a heat gun. That'll take some of the stickiness away. In fact, right here, as I say it, I could go from this way. Now, what I decided after looking at this, it kind of looks nice with the silver inside the canopy. With the tinted canopy and the silver, it adds a nice little, nice little color change there. Yep, there we go. There we go. There's two little spots I got to deal with here. I was hoping I'd minimize this. This would be no problem. Okay, now I wanted to glue this in, but I don't want to get glue all over the place. And I only get to do this once. Because if I pull the part back out, I'm going to see this glue. So I'm trying real carefully to do this once and then hold it in position. And see if it's my lucky day if this dries up. It could be a little bit further down this way. See, the reason I don't have to worry about this is because I can get in here and glue this from the bottom. I just need to hold it in place while all that dries up. Oh yeah, that's going to be nice. Our little hood there worked out pretty well. Oh, I got some decal setting solution here. I had my little pilot's name for inside the cockpit. I just want to see when this sits down if I'm going to like it. Just something a little different instead of putting it in electro sets along the side of the... This would be a little cuter. And this is a la Richard Oliver, the... any little decals. Rich made up the decals. A little bit of this, it softens the decals up. Not sure if I like that. Well, let's find out. I'll ask Karen, see, then I can get off the hook. I think we've reached a point of where I don't want to get it too busy. What this stuff does, it just sets the decals. Also, I don't have to worry about anything being fuel-proofed, hopefully, inside the canopy. That is one final thing I have to worry about. I don't want to seal this up. If I seal it up, it's going to have humidity issues and, whoa, look at this. Has it? I made sure I have little gaps around the edge so that it's not sealed up. And sometimes the decals can be a little snippy. Snippy's a good word. But the trick is take the Microsol and just keep brushing them down. They eventually will behave. As we've had on many of our, there we go. Now, I have to admit, in the very beginning of using decals, I was making myself crazy. And both John Pothier and Richard Oliver had made me so many different decals. And if I remember right, I think even Midgley ran some. It just was a hard learning curve that we've got on some of the old videos, but we've got to the point now where I think it's realistic to say we can use them. And this is one we'll just keep. The thing is, we just need to work it till it starts to dry down. Of course, it's cold in the shop right now. It's going to take longer than normal. Just keep taking our fresh Q-tips. And at some point in time, it'll sit down. And Joe Adamusco had trouble the first time he ran his decals off. But, and I know Richard Oliver's written about it in, I think, in Control Line World. One of the first issues, he had a nice thing about decals. But in this case, it's allowing us to put a couple extra little details in with almost no work at all, a matter of minutes. And at some point in time, you know, you hope anyway, it'll all lay down, and then we can move on to the next step. Okay, we're at the point where we can epoxy on the cockpit, and I wanted to show this in real time. I'm using 5 minute. If you were not comfortable with this, of course, probably be better to use slow drying. Again, about sealing this up. Now, this isn't sealed. There's little edges where it's not sealed, so to me it's not that important. But if you did seal it up, you'd want to have a pinhole in it underneath somewhere to let the moisture out, or so that when you're flying in a jetliner, the pressure doesn't blow the canopy off the plane or whatever could tentatively happen. I'm still not sure exactly how much of that is myth and how much is like Mythbusters. But I know for sure what I've done is leave little holes in the bottom and just put a little piece of coffee filter over it so that you don't get that big chunks of balsa and sawdust and everything that works its way up there. Anyway, the next step on this, pretty cut and dry. We want to get this in place. And we want to fill up the ditch, and then we will babysit this. We will babysit it for 10 or 15 minutes because we're going to have to refinish around the silver. And what happened is we had it on a table before and I had it sitting on something that had a little dent in it. So I've got a few little dents on the bottom to take care of. Now the idea is it doesn't matter what reaches out, what drips out the outside, but I don't want the inside dripping out. I'd like not to have a mess inside the canopy if possible. Any outside stuff, of course, will sand right out. We'll try to get that elusive razor edge, the coveted razor edge. Anyway, it's interesting to see how Charlie built his nose among. Gerald Champ has his own. I guess the kit is totally different too, I'm not sure. Interesting. I'm always interested in seeing how people come up with different little creative ideas that can be used. I think, and I'm not sure, I think I have this just about busy enough to look like it should be in an old-time stunt plane, and not in a scale plane. We've tried not to overdo it. Boy, when I look back years from now at the year of building a big job, the thing I'm going to remember is the weather. Wow. We are living in Montana here. Now again, I'm not really concerned at all with what goes on the outside. I'm not even going to worry about it. It's the inside. I don't want to have big icicles. Now, I can get rid of this, make sure my hand is clean so I don't mess this up too much. Just stick this in so that I have a little bit of a glue footprint there. Try to drop it right down in the groove. And now the hard part is going to be the babysitting. I would like to keep it right in that groove. Make sure it doesn't walk up and away. Oh! And it's only because we do have time here to do this. Needs a little bit of a squeeze there. I can get some of this out. We certainly got plenty up in the front here. Now, if this were a bigger canopy, I'd think about putting those pins and filling it with epoxy and whatever, but this is a relatively small canopy. I don't think that's really ultimately necessary. I'll just keep doing what I'm doing here. I wanted to show this kind of in real time, but I'll give this another, maybe 10 minutes. I can feel the epoxy going off here already. And just keep pressing it down. And we'll come back to this when this canopy's all dried up. Now, the last thing is to pour a cup full of this alcohol out. While this is still just semi-sticky, get whatever I can off of it. Even though we've gotten most of it off while it was liquid, now that it's hardened up, I can still get some of it off. It just be a big saving in terms of sanding. And the other thing is, because this canopy, I'm just constantly, I call this babysitting, and I got a big fingerprint up here. Can you believe this? Good thing we have the alcohol. Constantly babysitting this. Because if there is any spot where it's not catching real good right now, it'd be a good time to find out where it is.
And I think that cockpit, I am really happy the way that worked out. Now what's going to happen, what I've got a plan on, and believe it or not, we have more snow coming tomorrow. I've got a plan on as part of the next thing for this cockpit detailing thing. The next part of this, I've got to tape off, and I'm going to let this sit. I'm not going to do it right now. In fact, I'm not going to do it till tomorrow so that this epoxy is good and hard, because I don't want to put pressure on it. So it's better for me. Now, what I have to do is I have to fix the bottom of the body. See, I put a couple little chunks in it there. I've got to do that. That's why I'm sitting on a nice pad right now. Just in the nick of time, too. I hope you notice. Just right after the boat sinks, he buys a bilge pump. But we're gonna be refinishing silver one more time. And what I want to do is mask off. And what I'll do is I'll do this tomorrow. I'll mask off the cockpit, do this red lead repair. And I'm just babysitting this now. And you know what? We're at the end of a day, and I'm just feeling real good that this worked out as nice as it did. I like the look. I like the amount of detail. I like the textures. I like the little instruments. I like the little sunshade, the way that worked out. And the thing is, every one of these cockpits is just a little bit different. There's no such thing as like I saw this thing for RC models where it's made up, the parts are all detailed for you. You just glue them together and stick them in a plane for a big Dynajet or a big one of those turbine jets. And I know this is overkill to be babysitting this, but if I put this aside and then I'll be thinking, uh-oh, it popped off or something. So this way I know, and I have about a half an hour left. I want to finish this. I want this to be, I don't want to be tempted to rush this and go taping this off and fixing it tonight. I'll have plenty of time to do that tomorrow, especially if it snows like they're predicting. And so far, their predictions have been coming pretty true. But okay. I really think a cockpit adds more interest to a model than a lot of people realize. And even if you paint it on, there's no reason not to make it as nice or realistic or whatever as you can. See, this is what I mean about babysitting. If I didn't see that little glob tomorrow morning, that'd be a half hour of sanding and block sanding. Where right now, get it made in the shade here. And I do like the look of the blue flashing through into the silver. Now, one of the next things we have to do, not going to do it today, but one of the things we have to do, one of the next steps on this model is going to be, I have to mix up the custom colors, and I have to figure out how I want to lay out the paint job. So I have this terrible habit that I never do that until a day. I don't even like to mix the paint ahead of time. But the color Midgley sent me up is a very nice, like a candy apple blue, similar to Brodak candy apple blue. So we're going to be mixing that up. But if you look at this right now and you think to yourself, now in the last, actually this took two full days, not full sessions because we've had other issues to work on, but this was about, well, a session and three quarters, I think would be a fair number to say. And this is the little thing I like, is when you pick it up, you see that glass reflecting in there? And we got that little texture look going on in the seat where it looks like vinyl. Well, I'm just sitting here admiring the little effort that we've had in the last couple of days to do this. But I think basically this is the end of this session. And in fact, as I look at the clock here, it's actually the end of this DVD. So what I think I'll do, I have a few minutes left, but it won't be enough to put something major on. The few minutes that are left, I'll put some outtakes from one or the other cockpit videos that may have some interesting information that'll complement this. And this will then become our new 2010 cockpit video. So Anyway, thanks for joining us, and big jobs forever. And I hope you enjoy these outtakes. Several people have told me they like it a lot, in fact, so I tend to think maybe they're okay. And we'll see you on the next tape. Enjoy these outtakes.
If you're really, really wanting to do a super canopy. And it's always, in one of my goals is to make it as realistic as possible. Make it look like a cockpit, not just a bunch of map makers and map pins and stuff. Within the confines of, we don't want it to be too heavy, and we don't want it to take 4.5 years to build. Scale planes we've made. We try to make the cockpit, it's not really a scale model, but what we would like it to be is when you look in that it looks like a scale model. And the most with the Seafire, which we could fly with the cockpit open or shut, and had the pilot from Georgino. Had one feature that I really thought was pretty inventive is you could, through two little screws inside the plane, take the cockpit details out and put them in the next Miss Ashley. Now, needless to say, when we did the carbon plane, one of the factors is we were running out of time. And so we went with just having a carbon fiber. I wanted as much carbon fiber on a plane as possible. And that was one of the ways we achieved it, by just making a carbon fiber cockpit of version of the wood fuselage Miss Ashley. Sure, I really liked the way that worked. I thought that's something that had a lot of good features. This was a very nice by the way, that there's a video available on doing this. There's video for doing all the cockpits if you really want to go and push it to the limit. Valkyrie, this was in the early 60s. This is the one I finished. I refinished a plane that this was Harold's original Valkyrie. I flew this at the 61 Nats, but I remember thinking, wow, this was the first plane I ever made that had a real cockpit and pilot and some instruments, and I really was excited about that possibility. Tommy Looper did it, but I'm not sure, but just another, it's a nice little detail touch. And I certainly think it's worth the effort if you have the time and the inclination to do it. This was the 96 Spitfire. He had a shrunken down stunt news in the cockpit. I don't think you can see it here. As if the pilot were reading stunt news. And it was the stunt news that had his picture on the cover. I think it had the two Spitfires on the cover. I'm not sure. But I thought that was kind of a cute touch. And I'm always looking for cute little things like that to set the model apart. In this case, we wanted to bring it up to silver before I actually lay out the cockpit. The reason is I want to take a 3-view and I want to get the relationship, what percentage the cockpit is from the front to the back. Before you can lay out a cockpit, you've got to know where it's going to go. Now, in some designs, like a Nobler, for instance, it's pretty predetermined where it is if you have a turtle deck. In the case of a bubble canopy, a lot of times just sliding it forward or back the slightest bit changes the whole look of the airplane. So the first thing I want to do is I want to go measure off a drawing what percentage the canopy is from the front to the back. And remember, a Typhoon is it's a large airplane, so the canopy is smaller in proportion to the plane, say, than a Mustang is. The canopy is too far forward, it starts to look like a jet. If it's too far back, well, you can figure that out. You'll lose the look that you're looking for. We always have a box with a whole bunch of canopies in it and different things that we've molded up here. I thought at one time, and I'm not sure I can or can't, I thought I'd possibly be able to use a Seafire canopy because it's very similar, but when I looked at it from a lot of different angles, it's relative to the size of the plane, it seems like it's on the big side. So what I did, I ordered up one of every reasonable size of the SIG canopies. When I just roughly looked at one of the Seafire canopies, I just thought it just was too large relative to the size of the plane. The dimension from front to back was way out of proportion, and it sat up way too high. Because in essence, a Seafire, it's probably the same canopy, but a Typhoon is a much larger plane. So what I did, and I'm not sure, see, the first decision I have to make, of course, is not only where the canopy is going to be. If you put it up here, it starts to look like a jet. You move it too far back, well, I don't know what it looks like tsunami. But it's always good to have, and I just want to show this, a bunch of canopies. Canopies are real cheap, so it pays to have a couple of each. And I'd never buy one of each. I'd buy two or three, because if you cut one and you cut it a little too short, then you're basically stuck. So by having... By the way, this is why I always get more than one canopy, because let's just make an example up. Supposing I cut this too far, well, it's handy not to have to either run to the hobby shop, or in a case of if you mold it, it'd have to go mold another one. And we molded enough of those canopies. Just too bad we don't have the time. I wish we had the time to make a unique mold for this plant, but just we're running out of time.
Carbon, we have a little bit different technique that we're gonna use. This gets us the final little angle.
Okay, I also have another option, because I have the original blank. This was the original plug from the mold. And what I'm doing now is I want to get just a final fit where I can really press down on this. You could use a baseball bat. I've seen that as one of the tricks. But here's the reason for doing this is now in here, you can see we have a serrated, not a serrated, but a rough edge. Because we're going to be doing a butt joint. We're not going to have a little ditch. If we had a ditch, this wouldn't be as important. But we're going to have a rough, I want a rough surface, because we're going to use epoxy to hold that down. I want this curve to be a really good match, and I want it to be a rough joint, not a smooth joint, without making a big problem. Okay, so we have a look that we're looking for, and then I've used a little catchphrase of the bulldog. A Typhoon is not a long, sleek, narrow plane. It's kind of a, like a Bearcat or a Thunderbolt. It's kind of a heavy, heavily armed, fat plane. And this, I think, is going to capture the look. The thing that I don't want to do is I don't want to come out onto the fuselage any further than I have to, just the thickness of the canopy. And once I have that outlined, one of the things I can do is see that it's centered this way and this way. See that these curves, one doesn't stick up further forward than the other. And that's basically going to be, that's the area we want to detail for our cockpit right there. And it should be that a minimum amount of tension, in this case, if I just touch it with one finger, that all edges touch at the same time. There's no tension on it in any dimension. Try to do was build on, in other words, the little invention, or I'm not sure I invented it, but of being able to take the cockpit out. Now it gives me there's a couple of advantages. The cockpit usually weighs between a half ounce, maybe an ounce. But what it'll allow me to do if I fly this plane in F2B is just take the cockpit out. Another thing by having a take apart cockpit, one of the things I can always do is get in there and clean the windshield. A lot of times you get a plane that's a year old and all the dust winds up in there. And you can never get it out. It looks terrible. I've seen some planes look like somebody, sawed a piece of wood or something inside the cockpit. But anyway, that gives us a lot of choices. Now, even if this were not a take-apart plane, you know, it limits the things you can do. But I really like the idea that I'm going to be able to get out there and take that out. Now, it's a totally different shape. If this were a Mustang kind of body, I would just use these cockpit details. I wouldn't even make other ones. This is a much wider fuselage, and because of the shape of it, we want to make it more prototypical. So the first thing we need to do is cut a hole in the fuselage the size of where the pilot would actually sit. Be up maybe an eighth of an inch would be plenty. I don't want to see that glue seam if possible. Okay, now next step, of course, is to just cut that out. Always try to rough cut it with a spiral cutter, and the last little bit I'll do with a grinding tool. Concerns I had was this is right at the weakest point of the fuselage. I was wondering if I was going to lose strength. No way on earth. The fuselage is so strong. If this were wood, this would be not a great place to cut a big hole. I gotta tell you a funny story. Years ago, I don't even remember which plane it was, but I made this really neat cockpit box like this. And I did it outside the model. I made a little frame out. And when I went to put it in a plane, of course it was not a take-apart plane. What happened? I went to drop it in. Everything was great. I said, oh boy, that looks great. The pilot looks great. And then I tried to move the lead outs. And what happened? It was interfering with the push rod. And then I tried to raise it up. It looked terrible. The pilot's head hit the cockpit. And then I tried to cut the bottom of it off. And oh, God. Now, I'm just going to mention something because a lot of people are not doing this type of construction. When you put a cockpit on, you're making a sealed area in effect. And it's if you leave big holes, holes like eighth-inch holes, so air can get in there to get the moisture out. I'm sure you've all seen planes that have foggy cockpits. What happens, it's best to leave about an eighth-inch hole and then put a piece of coffee filter around it so that air can get in, but not the balsa dust. In this case, we don't have to worry because we'll always be able to do this. Just unbolt the cockpit and get in there with a Q-tips and or whatever, a rag, and clean it out. Thing is I want to measure up this hole and cut up the box sides at a 16th C grain balsa so it'll have a little rigidity. It'll just make the box that will become the removable part of this. 16th C grain because it's more rigid. I don't want the part to be any flimsier than it has to be, and I don't want it to be any thicker than it has to be because I'm going to do a lot of detailing. I can make any pattern. Just looking at some of the drawings, I have just a random, we're not trying to match an exact pattern, but something that would be typical of a World War II plane. How would that fit you? He doesn't like that. Anyway, this is dry now, and I want to start making sure this box fits exactly the way I want it before I do any more of the detailing. That when we put the zinc oxide colored paint on here, it'll really start to look like the inside of a World War II aeroplane. Well, it allows you to make some pretty realistic looking lightning holes in what should be simulated aluminum. And it's best to just go get something that has a zinc oxide color, or even better, just go buy some zinc oxide. Zinc chromate, I'm sorry. This is my real scientific way of matching colors. If anything, you want it a little bit on the light side because it will dry darker. And just keep mixing it until it's something like zinc chromate. The color about right. This is just to make it even more dull and fill in the wood grain in a very few coats. You can mix this up. A very scientific, accurate formula. And that's going to be our base coat for everything inside the cockpit. Of course, we usually get more paint on our hands than in the jar. And now, because this is a flat color paint, the talc will help fill in about two coats. It doesn't really have to be perfect at this point in time. So I need a first coat, but I want to get in all of the lightning holes. So when this is done, I want to make these three-dimensional. Eyeball it up. So what do? I start the notches first, make sure I have an evenly spaced. And then just go ahead and make them a little bit deeper. Now what I'm doing, I'm putting a little bit of a recess in the middle of this. By the way, this has been from Al Raby's plans and redrawn by Bob English. Hole first, and then go out, rough cut this, and grind the rest in. There's no other easy way I know how to do this, and the material with the grains all in different direction makes for a nice solid part. This is of course the yoke, and that's very similar to what the real yoke looks like. Bud McKnight sanding stick here. And of course it's delicate, and for almost sure we're going to break it at some point in time and have to CA it, but I'm going to radius it all off, and this is what the yoke in a Typhoon really looks like. They call it a shovel yoke. This down. His adult feathers at last. See those little orange quills? I'm going to put you in a cockpit of the plane. Enough. We got cockpits to work on. Adult feathers. This is the mount that the yoke sits on, because in the real plane this rotates back and forth, and I'm just going to use a washer to simulate the bearing surface up there. It's pretty prototypical, by the way. So impressed with those adult feathers on that bird. Nice, we can use the little forceps to hold it in position. I want to get a radius on this, because on a real plane this is a rubber, actually. We're pretty much at the end of this day. We're going to work on tomorrow some more detail. This will get painted once it dries. And we'll just let that dry. And it has that shiny look. Once it dries, we'll just make this the zinc chromate color. And that's a pretty good simulation of a rubber part. Next thing I'm going to have time for tonight is just to make up a little emergency brake lever. I bent the pin, put it in between two sheets of 64th plywood, and just fill a gap with glue. Rest with a Dremel tool. And one of the things you can do, you can just kind of carve a hand grip in there. I wouldn't want to paint the plane with this or anything, but little details. So a little bit of dye, commercially available any place they sell fiberglass supplies. Mix it with any kind of resin, even 5 minute. I want to just see what I'm doing to get the, let me see if I can get a good close up on this. Just rub them before the dope dries, before the epoxy dries. He puts the little handle. This reminds me of one little thing. We made a little easy just handle one time and put it in Mike Rogers' cockpit. Made a little line reel on an easy just handle. That was kind of a cool thing. Anyway, that's it for today. We'll be back in the shop tomorrow. Day one of the great cockpit event is over. I'm trying to rough this out right now. And I want to carefully, because it'll dry slow, I want to get a good bond on this. I'm going to glue it right to a piece of 600 wet and dry sandpaper. And the reason for this is it gives a texture. And a real dashboard would have some kind of anti-glare panel. And this would be a good simulation of that, I hope. Here. It's easier to do it from the back because you don't get a smear on the front. If you do, it's hard to get it off. And that's the base of a relatively nice, even if this were in a Nobler or Thunderbird or whatever, a nice dashboard. But we're going to take it to the next level. Before I go on to the further detailing of this, next step I want to do is I want to get the grain cross grain. I want to make a floor. I'm not going to glue it in place yet. I want to make a floor. And as the texture for the floor, one of the things I like to use is some other grade of sandpaper, which we'll see, they're all darker or lighter depending on the grade. And that gives a nice anti-glare look when you look into the cockpit box, the part of the floor that you can see. I wanted to see, I never glued it. The problem is never glue it together until you really have to, because it's easier to work on it in parts and make it like a little take-apart cockpit. Now, the next thing I want to do is I'm just making sure I have this the way I want it. I want to make up little aileron pedals, simulated aileron pedals. This is, let's see what it is. I don't even know. Shows you what I'm... The thing that destroys a lot of nice little cockpits is you only have one or two different textures, and it just looks fake. The more textures you can put in there, it kind of, any model maker will try to get as many textures as you can involved. I got these from Dave Midgley. I'm not even sure where you could buy them. But what's nice about it is the aluminum that they come in. How creative is this? Just, first off, you can use the blade for whatever. But it's the soft aluminum that makes for some very realistic parts. Hey, get out of there! Yeah, I'm looking through the eyepiece all of a sudden, I see a bird's head. God, amazing I get anything done. Now you just do this with your finger, and you could cut yourself on this, so you want to be careful. And it really does leave a nice simulated look of real aluminum. CA that down. Now what I'm going to do is cut a little bit around it and wrap it back over itself, like wrapping a Christmas present. I was, and I wasn't happy with it. I thought I was going to be able to put pen lines in this. But I like the look that it has the little lines. You really can't see it probably on the camera. It has the little lines like the real plane does, at least in the photo. It has the lines, so I'm just going to leave the lines in there. Seems to look the best is to just take an ordinary ballpoint pen and put the lines. The real plane has serrations, of course, I guess so the pilot's feet don't slip off the aileron pedals. And then just wipe the ink out, because it leaves an impression in a very soft aluminum. Now once that's in there, you can see the reflection of the aluminum, and that's what I want, is when it looks, when you look in the sun, look like what aluminum pedals, or I'm sure they were zinc chromated and the paint wore off on most of them. Most of the pictures you have, they're almost bare metal. You can pick up off the video. I started out with one shape, and I'm looking at a picture of how I want this to look, and I want this to fit into the cockpit with a little bit of clearance on each edge. So, but for a piece of scrap wood, whenever you make a part you're not happy with, just make another one. That's the nice part about doing these little details. It's really nice to be able to just be able to make another part. Not like when you build a wing and you're all done and it has a twist in it or something. Anyway, that will be the base of our seat for now. I want this to have a little bit of a curve in it when I glue it in place. The next thing I want to do is put the grab rails in on the corners here. Usually when you get in, there's something to grab on. I try to make these look as, well, realistic as possible. The next thing I want to do, I want to make a little headrest for the pilot, which is just a piece of carved balsa wood. Illusion of depth. Different textures, just slightly different colors. Sometimes you could just put a little silver in there, make it look more metallic. Now we'll leave the bottom unpainted, because what we want to do when we do is cut the sandpaper away and glue a little mount on this once we determine the final height. Sometimes you can get away with one coat, but more than likely this will take two. I wanted to make a few more, so what I did, well, I may as well show making one on. Cut up some pins, take this over to the vise and hammer this flat.
Quite easy, just to smash the end of it and at the same time smash your fingernail. I can Dremel tool a little radius on the edge. Of course they need a little dressing off, but another nice little easy detail to make. Most of these little details, let's see if we can find some little tiny washers for this part too. Even just these switches in World War II planes, they typically were toggle switches. Smallest washers are always at the bottom of the box. Can't believe it. Anyway, what we're looking for is exactly these little guys. No idea what they are. 080 washers, I think. And get them relatively straight. Of course, if you really want to be fanatical, you can make some switches on and some off. And there's a height at which they look just about right, and that's definitely not it. I have a little piece of Teflon paper. If they're too far in, it's no good either. Then we're going to mix up some black epoxy. And that's about what a switch would look like. Of course, the trick is a little bit of black dye. If you can see this, when I did this the first time, I basically saw these in Keith Trossel's Scale Martin Baker, and I think he told me how he did them. I don't remember if he told me or one of the guys in RC Scale. Could be I'm giving the wrong person credit, but anyway, Keith has been so helpful on other things, and it was good to see that he won the Nats there in last year or the year before. That plane is really a cool plane. Now, when I get the epoxy on, of course, then I'm going to hit this with a hairdryer, and that'll make it a little more liquidy and a little shinier all at the same time. Those little switches, they do look like toggle switches when they're done right. A little bit of a, the runoff runs onto the end of the switch, which makes it look even more like a toggle switch. Oh yeah, it's gonna look great. In fact, we can so little by little this is shaping up, but there's always one little detail I add to planes, and it's the little accessory lights that they do appear in real planes. Now the way I simulate them is with little jewels from a craft store. In the past I've bought little packs of jewels and these little rhinestones, and what I didn't realize there was a better source for it is the local nail supply place that sells, let me get these all in here, that sells the girls, you put these on their fingernails, the ones that want to look like, you know, high-tech fingernail jobs. But anyway, they're the perfect size, and the difference is the fingernail rhinestones, the ones I used to buy, had a point and you'd have to drill a hole. These are flat, and with one little drop of epoxy, they should adhere right in place. Now I want some red ones, of course, and they're at a perfect scale. We just have to figure out exactly where we want to have these. And like any jewel accessory, when the sun hits it just right, boy, that just really adds a nice look to it. And it's a combining of textures that really makes this more realistic than it otherwise would be if it was just one flat color. Kind of happy with the way this little guy is working out. And there's nothing here. There's certainly nothing that costs any money. There's nothing here that's out of the realm of an average modeler. It's just time. This is, I think, the third or fourth day. I try to spend a couple hours each night, each afternoon, working on it. And reviewing the videos for even more ideas. Probably if there's a fingernail place near your house, you could probably get the people to just give you three or four of these. So I pick them out with a wet end of a toothpick,
And I'm just going to mix up just one blob, put it on the end of a toothpick of some 5-minute epoxy. A small detail, but when that reflects, especially in the bright sun, when you're looking at cockpit, that adds a nice little touch. It only takes a few minutes to put them in. And it can simulate any number of things, the lights, gear up, landing lights on. We don't know since it's a fantasy airplane. But when it's sitting at certain angles, you can see them, look, even with my hand in a shadow, you can see it looks like they sparkle on and off. Use one of these type of things, I fold it back up, and I put it back into that envelope so the next person, whoever that's going to be that borrows it, like all Letra sets, they'll have access to some of the jewels and they can doll up their model too. Our trim wheel right up here. Make up a little plate. I want to have the blind, that's a little bit of oil on the threads before I glue them in, and I'll cut this in half so I'll have one for the front and one for the back. All right, I hot stuff that to a piece of scrap. Now I can cut it in half. I want to make one in the front and one in the back. That'll allow me to slide the cockpit up and down, and then I'll just tack glue on the mounts. Where so what it'll do, it'll give me an infinite amount of variation of going up and down on the cockpit. I wanted to have a little bit of variation if I wanted to lower them, just to get even a little more adjustment. And I thought this would give me a little bit a safety factor that the threads from this wouldn't go through and distort the fuselage, which we put a lot of time into getting a nice finish on. This is a critical part of it. I have both of the pieces in place, but they're not tack glued in yet. So what this allows me to do is slide this up and down, same in the front. I can slide them up, I can slide them down. I'll get the exact setting I want. Then I'm just going to put one drop of CA, thick CA here, to tack this in place, take the screws out, and that'll set my mounts. Because when this is away, yeah, I have infinite variation. Now this would help if you were making a plane with a push rod. A lot of times a push rod's in the way, like on a Miss Ashley, for instance. So this can allow you to set this at any exact angle you want, front to back, side to side. When you're happy with it, you can just tack that, and when you take that out, the tabs will be attached. And once they're pulled apart, then you can put a permanent glue seam here and maybe even a little reinforcement. The stone tends not to break up the plywood as much. We used almost a whole sheet of 64 plywood on this. Anyway, we're still under a half ounce, so we're safe. I don't want to start making this too elaborate. But I really do like the fact that when people look in there, they say, oh, how'd you do that? Part I made today was the support for behind a pilot's head, and I made it out of a piece of spare carbon fiber with balsa laminate. So if we decide to leave that carbon fiber color, this will kind of match. Not that that's a real important thing, but that's all we're going to get to do today. In between doing the world's greatest cockpit detail, Peeps is eating pound cake today.
You little pig face here.
Come on, the world is more than just doing cockpit detailing.
he's
going to eat a whole pound cake today.
Don Dixon thinks you're a pig, Peepster.
Little piggy pig.
Oh, my God, what a beast. What a beast. Go work on your canopy, Art Nowski. The next thing I want to make up is a little cushion. Typically what the pilots did is they sat on a cushion that either was or wasn't a parachute, but a little cushion will add some details in there too. I start with a little piece of 1/8-inch wood, and I'm just going to kind of sand and grind it to the shape that I want, and then put on a flat a flat finish, because it would try to make it look like some leather from World War II. Find it easiest to paint and work on it by just attaching. And that's one of the things you can pick up off the video, that some people usually have, and I'm one of them, have trouble figuring out how to hold things while they're painting and finishing, especially small little parts like this. Now, I mixed up some Brodak black paint, black dope, with a good amount of talcum powder, and it should cover in one or two coats, and it should dry to a relatively flat finish. May need a little bit of thinner on this. What I'm looking for is, when it dries, that it has the look of some worn out, dried out leather kind of look. For the backrest. And I was going to leave this carbon fiber, but the more I look at it, it just doesn't look realistic. And I thought maybe it would look like flat black if I sanded it with 1200. That didn't work. So what I'm going to do, of course, is paint it the zinc chromate color. First, I'll make this piece up out of 1/64 plywood, put the lightning holes in it, and then this will be ready for a coat of the zinc chromate. Now, I put that zinc chromate colored paint with the talc in it into my primer gun. I want to get a one coat on this and see how I like this. I believe the phone can be ringing at 6 o'clock in the morning. Just hard to believe. And once this dries, we'll see if we like the way it looks. It may need a little more talc in the mix. If it does, I'll just recoat it. While this oil is drying, I want to look at some of the other cockpits just to see if there's any other details I want to include in on this. And after looking over some of these, I think I've got pretty much everything I want to include on this. Except I want to put a little, let's see if I have some room for it, a little thermos bottle. I had one in the Sea Fire, and I have one extra one. I want to see if I can include that somehow in the cockpit detail. Now, a rich source of finding cute little stuff to put in a cockpit is always the dollhouse supply stores. And in a Sea Fire case, I had a little pizza. In this case, we have a thermos. In fact, we had a thermos exactly like this in the Sea Fire. It adds another nice little detail touch. And a little cushion seems to have, at least I'm kind of satisfied that that's added a little dimension to it. Well, that's all drying up. I want to lay out the ribbing. Because what I want to do, the ribbing goes around here, I want to take the canopy inside and paint it on the inside zinc chromate color. So that when you look through the canopy, you don't see the paint that's on the outside. You see paint that's on the inside and matches the canopy area. And we've done that pretty much on all of our semi-scale planes. Again, whichever model we're portraying here, we have plenty of details. What's nice about having all these books, and this is the model we're portraying, so we're gonna get all these outlines on the outside of the cockpit with tape, then flip it over and hand paint the inside. Okay, all the tape is on. Now we're gonna flip this over and just with a brush very carefully paint one thin layer of the zinc chromate on the inside. if you weren't comfortable doing this, again, you could mask it off. But because this is a part that I just want to go right up to the edge of the red, and then I use this piece. Look at those steady hands. He is of art training. I'll tell you, what a guy. Now, I don't want to get any dope in that flat edge that we're going to use to glue it down, because we're only going to have a very small glue footprint into the carbon. We don't have the ability to make a trough there. And everything else is drying up. I've walked around many times, looked for some more details, looked through my books again. I like the little thermos bottle. Anytime you're in a dollhouse store, you should always look around for something and just put it in a box for all the stuff that you think you're going to use in the future for cockpit detailing. And you always have to make the decision when you're making a model just how much time and energy and effort you want to put into it. Well, in this case, we feel like we'd like to make this as good as we possibly can, and little details like painting inside the cockpit when that's reversed, I think all of that adds a little special dimension to it. Whole paint, whole inside painted. Now once I take the tape off, that'll then become my pattern. It's a reverse pattern. I want to make sure I don't have any dope along this edge. So I'll just hit that with some sandpaper before I glue this on. I can take the tape off the edges here. Once we get this installed, I think that's really going to look... That's about as nice as I could have ever expected. The total weight was under a half of an ounce. I wanted to put some rivet heads. Add some details down in the cockpit area. It is a normal inclined pen with a number 45 tip. Now, most of these I just do freehand the same way as you would do inclines. You really want to be fussy, of course you could do with a ruler. Just adds another little detail in. And the more things you can do to keep your eye busy. I just think it looks more realistic. As soon as we're done putting some incline details in here, the next step is going to be to glue the canopy on. And I hope... And the last thing I want to do, I want to put the rivet heads inside the canopy, the bars that are going inside. So when you look inside, you see the rivets inside the glass of the canopy. In this case, I'm using the laundry marker. Simple reason here is because you're going to be looking through the glass, I want these rivets to be actually a little bit larger than the ones that we're putting on the inside of the cockpit. Reason for that is I'd like a little variety in it. I don't want it all to look exactly the same, like it all came out of the same pen. Vary in the thicknesses, vary the texture, vary the... Every time you can vary something, you add a little bit of interest to it. And see, when you look through, let's see if you can see that. When you look through, you'll see those rivets inside the canopy. What I'm gonna do is just make sure I have a nice clean edge to get the glue on. And I'll mix up some slow drying epoxy. The next step is going to be to just get a little bit of epoxy on here. Now the way to do this that I've found that works real well, I'm going to use the plug. I'm going to paint the epoxy on the plug, drop this down in place, and that'll just pick up the epoxy right on the edge without making big globs all over the place. A good substitute for that if you don't have a plug, if you're making a wooden fuselage, is just use a baseball bat. I want to mix the glue. This is the SIG epoxy, where one tube is twice the size of the other. Because I want to get a real thin bead in there, and I don't want to have it globbing up and glooping up. Is that a real word, gloop? Anyway, we're really getting to the point where we can start to see the results of this week or so of labor that we put into this. Now, I don't have the exact color green, but I figured this mustard color would help hide any epoxy that winds up inside the cockpit. And I'm trying to use the minimum amount of dye in here to make the color of the epoxy close to the color, but I don't want to reduce its strength, of course. Now, what I'm going to do with this, real high tech, I'm sure you're impressed with this. And when I'm done, I'll just clean this off. Is get a smooth bead on here. Now, if you're doing a permanent cockpit, of course, then you really have to watch, because then you can't get back in there and get any of the little mistakes out. In our case, we could get up in there with some Q-tips if we get a, or we can make some fancy tools to get in there. But I hope at least somewhat you're getting some of the ideas that it's taken me years to come across. Most of them I've stolen from other people without them wanting me to, but anyway. And the trick is just drop it right on, press it once. It's like making a rubber stamp. When we take it up, we should have, remember that word should. We should have the glue right around the exact, and it looks like we do. Can just drop it right in, and I can just, well, just make the finest little adjustments here. Thing is, you don't want to move it at all, of course. You see how thin that bead of glue? You can even wipe that if you want. But anyway, that is a trick worth its weight in gold. Now, it's funny, it seems like it was years ago. Seems like such a long time ago we were carving the plug for this fuselage. And this was all in the mind's eye, and here it is. Your life going before you. Anyway, what's going to happen now? I put a couple extra pieces of tape on here. Look for any drips or drools. That is going to sit overnight. We're going to come back and work on this tomorrow. And now what I want to do is back mask all the glass other than the area that we're going to ultimately paint. You can see what a nice thin bead of epoxy that put on there. And when you look inside the canopy, you almost can't see how that color, that mustard color, blended in there. Using the polywog to get, let me get the phone, get a nice radius on this anyway. I can't believe I could be this popular. I wish I was running a dating service. Anyway, I'm trying to get this radius in here, and I'll get some of this on a close-up, because I don't want to make it any thinner than I have to. I don't want the cockpit to become paper thin. These little sanding polywogs come in handy because they give you an impression. See where the black line is of how far you've gone, and when, you know, obviously you've gone too far. Now, this was such a good fit, it looks like we're not even going to need much, if any, of a radius there. But for sure, we want to roughen up the cockpit so the first coat of dope will get a bond. Now, if we wanted to build a bigger radius, we could build it with aeropoxy light, but looks like we're not even going to need a radius. Again, I think this is the best fit I've ever had on one of my canopy fits. And all the tricks we used, you know, usually everybody can use them no matter what plane they're building. They can do something pretty similar. Now, I need to feather this in with some 1200. And just get the last little feather edge in, and that's ready to spray. blended this all in. The trick to all this blending is each time you put a couple, maybe every other coat of paint, is to move the tape up a 1/64 of an inch so that you don't get that ridge there anywhere anywhere where it changes from paint to a clear canopy, because when you're all done, you want to be able to just run your hand over that and not have any lumps or ridges or anything on there. Anyway, this is ready for a coat of silver. No matter where I look at it, it still looks pretty good. It really does fit what I had in mind. Looks like we even have the proportion correct. And the next step's a coat of silver.
Now it's going to take several coats of silver to blend this in, but I think the fit is good enough that we're not going to need a fillet. If we do change our mind, we can put a little aeropoxy light fillet in there.
On the end of this video, and please remember that we have videos covering the cockpit detailing of several other planes. Strega, a bubble canopy. All of the Spitfire and Seafire videos that have each one as a unique entity. Sashley cockpit, which is a take-apart cockpit that you can use over and over again. Several, the Tsunami and the original Cardinal videos that detail doing our metal flake technique. Well, no matter what kind of canopy you're going to put on your next plane, I hope the videos and the presentation not only is fun to watch and enjoyable, but I hope you've learned something that you can use in your modeling, and it'll just add a new dimension to it. Now, this video is part of a subscriber set of videos detailing the building of the Typhoon. And if you're not already a subscriber, consider becoming one. And it outlines the detailing of many carbon fiber parts, cowlings, built-up wings, and of course the finish that's going to go on here in the next couple of months. Well, the weekend is here when we're going to try to get some flights. I just hope the weather's going to be... Boy, if you only know how nervous I get. Hoping we get some good weather this weekend. I'm going to try to do here, while Joe's done flying, we're going to try to get a ground run on this. I don't have the electronics package here today, so if we do get to fly it, we're just going to set it at half throttle and fly it. But we want to get a ground run first of all. We did a nice photo shoot with Art, and we're pretty much, our next step is get a run on it and see that there's no junk in the tank or whatever.
And like I said before, we don't have our electronics. Sergio was here and took the transmitter for a major modification that we want to use. So we're just going to kind of fool with the throttle, try to get it running about where we think it should be. And then we'll give it a little quick test flight at about half throttle, third throttle, whatever.
Second official, John DeTavio assisting, Typhoon, 91 four stroke.
Thank you, Larry.